So I'm gonna call the Finance Committee to order. Tonight's meeting is being recorded for RCTV Live. If you're watching, you're on Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33. The videographer for tonight's meeting is Rob. And with that, I think we'll get started. In thinking through kind of how we'll go through this, we're gonna go through the departments that are on the list, starting with Public Services. And then, so tonight's Public Services, Administrative, Finance, Public Safety, Bob will do shared costs. We'll wrap for tonight. And then next week, we'll do the other departments and then have a broad discussion of the entire town budget, including some of the items raised in Bob's memo, and go through that. So if there are specific questions that relate to that tonight, that's fine. But I think the discussion of how does everything add up and how we want to go through that, let's save that for next week. And we'll do it then. All right? So with that, Jean, come on up, please.
My pleasure. I'm going to be relatively brief, because I tend to be long-winded, so I'm going to change that tonight, and just kind of focus on, I'm going to start off with a few kind of overview remarks, and then I'm going to get into some specifics about what's different with this budget. So, broadly, Public Services Department has had some shifts, as you probably saw in the budget. The staffing model that we rolled out last year was similar to a lot of the other departments, where we have a pretty deep set of admin folks. So myself as the department head, and I have, in the previous year budget, there were two assistant department heads. So Public Services is sort of this unique collection of, I'll call it other. We have community development, which is all of the kind of nuts and bolts of building inspections, planning, and conservation. A lot of the land use boards fall under community development. And then community services are more the human services side, so human and elder services and recreation and veteran services and the like. So we had the two assistant department heads were overseeing each of those areas. And we had a someone leave who was the community services director, John Feudo, probably a lot of you know him. And when he left, we started thinking about could we think about how we staff this department differently, and with a very capable admin person in the rec administrator who'd been there, you know, quite a while. We thought, well, let's try maybe a different model and see if we flatten the organization, flatten the department, and get some more feet on the ground people, and use that money and reprogram it. So what you have in this budget is one assistant department head, which is Julie Mercier, who's here with me tonight, the community development director, and then myself as the department head. And we've taken that community services director position and rearranged it into a couple of other positions, bringing back the rec coordinator on a part-time basis to sort of fill in for where the need was there, and then bringing on something that we're describing as an administrative specialist. So one of the things that position did, the community services director, was to organize a lot of the components of what we call nighttime government, all of those many boards that fall under our department. And so that administrative specialist will be the bridge to nighttime government, focusing, for example, on the Zoning Board of Appeals, which has been enormously demanding. Julie and I went to, I don't know how many meetings, 9 or 10, 12 meetings over the last year just on the 40B down at the train station, not to mention countless hours of crafting decisions and reviewing plans and peer review and that kind of thing. So nighttime government is a tremendous demand on public services, and having a key person that can coordinate a lot of those pieces will be enormously helpful to running the department. So that's probably the biggest piece of what changed. The financial side of that is almost nothing. We actually went down, I think, in the budget, less than 1%, but there was an overall decrease. So moving on to kind of where we've been and kind of what we've built, the division heads were, back in FY16, were upgraded to full-time, almost all of them. The only one that isn't is Human and Elder Services, which is a part-time position, and she's been on board for quite a while now. Jane Burns does a great job. And she has a number of full-time people that help, including the nurse advocate, that really supports that division. And you might recall that we, last year, with the Board of Selectmen's guidance, added a position, the Economic Development Director. And that's been a really great addition to promote one of the key goals of the town, which is to get some more economic development so we can move that needle and get the revenue that we need to support the budget. And that position, as you might recall, is budget neutral because it's paid for out of the Permits Revolving Fund. So it's really not digging into the budget to afford that. It's taking money out of the revolving fund and putting that in there. So again, it was a busy year. We, again, over had 1,000 building permits, and that was a lot. The model that we're using for inspections is a series of part-time, highly experienced employees, building inspectors who've been the inspector of buildings in their respective towns before they retired. So it's great having that depth of experience. We also promoted the administrative assistant who is working exclusively in building to the permits coordinator. And that's really what makes this model work. And we've had great success with her work ethic and her ability to use the technology. So we're doing things in a way that is, I think, far superior to how we've ever done them, and certainly when we compare ourselves to our neighbors, we're issuing at least half of the permits the same day that they're being applied for. So that's a pretty remarkable statistic, and when I started looking at it, I was even kind of surprised that we're doing it so quickly, and probably another 25% are within a matter of a couple of days because somebody didn't bring their license or there was some minor thing. So it's really a process of expediting permits, still doing everything according to what needs to be done, but doing it in a way that's expedited and that relies more on somebody who really has the skills in the admin side to communicate back and forth with the contractors and schedule the inspections. The one thing that we also added in January was Friday inspections, and I know we've talked about that here, about town hall being closed on Fridays, and what does that mean for projects that, you know, someone needs to pour a foundation and they can't get an inspection on a Friday and holds them up. So we've come up with a way to, again, schedule that part-time team so that we have plumbing, electric, and building on Fridays available to do inspections. Now, sometimes they do them on Thursday and they don't, you know, solve that problem, and that's fine. But we do require that they call in early Thursday morning. They can't call at 5 o'clock and think they're going to get an inspection the next morning. But it seems to be working, and with the recent snowstorm that happened on Sunday into Monday, having those inspections done on Friday meant that it didn't affect anybody with the weather. So we're finding that whole division should be working very, very well.
That's a great reaction to hearing.
Yep.
Because I definitely heard that. So
yep.
You're able to meet that.
You know, I think we're going to see probably a lot more of it in the spring, but we're seeing it already as a good service. So we're happy we can do that. And again, it doesn't really affect the budget. We're scheduling these part-time people in a way that they're very flexible, so they don't mind. You know, it all works out.
In effect, those are paid for by the revolving fund. Inspections.
Not the inspections, no. The revolving fund is paying for the economic development director, but the budget, the way we have these three part-time inspectors, building inspectors scheduled, they're in a way that it's like 19, 19, and I think 10. They're all covering for each other, and so that's coming out of the actual annual budget.
Okay.
But because we're...
the permits don't... those don't indirectly fund it, the permits just go into the general funds?
Yeah, the permits revolving fund gets those larger projects go into that, and then we use it for in the budget for support, and then we use it for the economic development director. But you'll see it in there under support, and so that's that is feeding into it broadly into that line item, So you, that's probably what you're thinking of.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. So again, going into planning, we are very eager to get going on the economic development work that we've begun over the past few years, and the economic development director's making a lot of progress. We also are very pleased that we've finalized the permitting guide that we've been working on. So there's actually now a guide that you can go to for if you want to open a business and you want to understand what do I do with the health department and what do I need to do for this. So we have that ready to go. We're continuing with so many projects in planning, and there's so much activity in the queue. Probably not a lot that's gone through the CPDC yet, but that's that we expect to see over the next several months. And so that's exciting. We're working hard at achieving our state mandate of 10% affordable housing. We just submitted some material to the state to request what they call a certification. Because of this 40B now, we're in a position that we've created the benchmark that they're looking for to basically have a year off from 40Bs. So fingers crossed, if the state gives us our approval, then effective whenever they do that, we have a hold on 40Bs, at least for a year. We may be able to go back and ask for another year if we know we're gonna get a few more projects, and that may put us over as well. So we're very laser focused on that so that we can kind of catch our breath a little bit with 40Bs. It really is a huge drain on resources. I guess it really isn't anything else on the community development side. On the community services side, human and elder services, we are in the process of working with UMass Boston on a master plan so that we can be projecting out what we think our needs might be. It's a busy place with over 40 programs at the senior center, and of course the van is a big high demand activity. The public health, we had 1,000 flu clinics this past year. I'm sorry, 1,000 flu vaccines given out this past year, and several new food establishments that have come in, which is good. REC has had over 450 activities, and all the things that they're involved in sell out very quickly. And veterans, is working hard to make sure that those VA benefits are going to the right people and are correctly administered, and also much more of a presence at the senior center, which is working out very nicely. So that's my overview. The current budget, as I mentioned, it's a reduction of 0.51%. Salaries decreased by 1.33. It's roughly a level budget. These numbers are so minuscule. I mentioned the new administrative specialist position and the REC coordinator position, which would be part-time. I mentioned the promotion, and also that it may look strange in the budget. We're planning, seems like the number went up, and that's because that position got put into planning. So it's showing maybe half of the fiscal year sitting in planning, which artificially inflates it, but it's moved over from admin to the planning line item. We have one retirement, the office manager. She's going to come back part-time, so that was another little decrease on the admin side. And we added a few hours on the inspectors. That's a slight increase, again, based on activity. And mostly that is plumbing and electric, not the actual building inspectors. And that's a 6% total increase. And we had a small budget decrease in human and elder services wages. That's really not a decrease, it's grant money that's going into the budget. So if it looks strange, that why would we be decreasing? We're not. It's just a decrease to the budget because we've got grant funds coming in.
Oh, so that wasn't any staff change?
No, everything's the same. It's just the grant picks up more of the cost. And expenses, there's a slight 2.31% increase because we put in a little bit extra for vets, anticipating that there could be a little bit higher trend with that activity. And just the last note is that REC, the revolving fund, directly pays all of the expenses. So the revenue that's generated typically results in funds being turned back to the town. And that's probably equal to the wage cost of the division. So again, that's another division that is pretty self-supporting.
How long is that grant for?
It's an annual grant. It just was a little higher this year because
it's one we've been getting.
We've been getting, it's just higher, and they do it on the number of seniors, so it's, we had, I guess, an uptick in the count, so we got more.
I've got a couple of questions.
Sure.
On inspection. Is there a way to estimate how many smaller projects go without actually getting permits?
I wish.
Wait, what, Ken, is there a gut feel? More importantly, is there anything we can do about it? Obviously,
well, the good news
is
people
better,
rat each other out a lot. So that's mostly how we find out. And once we find them.
Is there a hotline?
We have our ways.
Is that a big chunk that's leaking out, do we think?
I don't think so.
No?
No, I don't think so. I mean, we talked a little bit about at the Board of Selectmen meeting about fees, and so we are looking at that. I don't think we're that far off, but we could probably take a good hard look. And before we do anything, I would want to really look at it closely and compare ourselves, because we're trying to promote economic development. So do we increase fees? Does that send the wrong message? We're trying to be business friendly. We're trying to make it easy for people to come in and open businesses and have thriving businesses. But we could probably do some small tweaks. It's not going to be a big increase in revenue if we make those tweaks, the ones that we are taking a look at. They're small changes in plumbing fees and fixture counts, and it's really minutia.
Yeah, but we're in the mode of every little bit helps, so I think we don't really have a choice but to look at those. What's the timing? Are those set annually? Do they go into effect in January?
Well, we have to, anything we do with fees has to be approved by the Board of Selectmen. So
right.
I think we want to do our research and then make a presentation. And we've talked about it broadly, but we've collected some data over the past few years. And so we just need to go back and update that.
Is there the opportunity to change at any time through the selectmen, or is it a particular time of year it has to happen? Bob is going to comment.
Yeah, the only fee that you really have to watch the calendar on is the NIPO. That's an annual sticker. And generally, and you guys jump in, I've told the board if they want to make a change, they should decide by September, maybe early October. That's enough time for have these guys set up and order whatever the proper amount and types of stickers are for sale in December. Any other fee can be changed at any time. And what the selectmen discussed in January is with an upcoming competitive race for the selectmen, you got to wait till after the election at a minimum.
Which is next month, so not too far away.
Right.
Sorry, one other question, if I could, on the recreation in particular. So that's obviously a huge change in structure. And is it possible to come close to the same kind of high level of service that we were getting with that much less resource, or is this just the reality of less resource, less is going to happen?
They're getting more resources because the community services director was overseeing the whole division. So that position was managing three other divisions plus rec. Now what we're saying is we're not going to have that, and so we're taking the high-level administrative role away, and we're feeding it back in into an actual rec coordinator. So I've had a lot of discussions with the rec administrator, and she's fine with, this model. And I think that, rec is one of those things where you get a lot of volunteers, a lot of people are pitching in and doing going to events and helping out. So it's really more the model we're trying to move to, which is to try and give the divisions the nuts and bolts that they need, and maybe not so much of, monthly meetings on what the status is on things, actually doing programming. So I'm feeding the funds into the actual programming, not the managing of the programming.
Sorry, one more on Veterans Services. I know in 17 there was a big change, big increase, and and I know we've got a lot of discussion about good and better services and singing the praises of the administrator. Are we on track with that? Are the 18 increases not very much? Is it, does that make sense where we are?
I think so, yeah. It's hard to know. I talk to the VSO all the time about, you know, do you have enough resources? Do we need more? Is there too much? And he's told me that he's perfectly happy with what we have. He's trying to make that program work so that those that are eligible are getting the benefit, and he's very careful to make sure that the benefits are not, you know, going when somebody might lose their eligibility, as awful as that would be, but he's careful to make sure he's got his eye on the ball and is properly being administered. So I think we're okay.
Is he full time now?
Yes, he is. Yeah, every division head except for Human and Elder Services is full time.
Sorry, other questions?
I have one more clarification. How do I read the numbers here? What's the revised budget 2017 versus actual?
I should probably explain that.
Yeah.
FY17 is what was spent at the date that these reports were run, so they're a little more than halfway through the year. The revised budget just means there might have been something done at November town meeting, so rather than use last April's budget, you need to use the November budget, and technically that's called the revised budget.
And you show year to date how much you've spent towards
right.
that. So far. Okay.
Yeah, so when these were all run, you know, a smooth calendar break even would have been around 60% is what should have been spent. So if it's more or less than that, there's got to be a reason for it.
Thanks.
Eric, do you have a question?
Yeah, a couple. Thanks, Jim. So if I interpret all the moving parts, are you flat on the FTEs? Did I read that right?
Yeah, pretty much. It ends up kind of being a wash to take that assistant department head and kind of break it up into a couple of parts.
Right.
So it ends up being about the same as last year.
I tried to count on the org chart. I came up with 22 FTEs.
That's right. Okay. Yep, that's what I came up with.
Cool. If I can just add, though, it's the same FTEs, but if you look at the middle of page 34, it's $35,000 worth of wages.
Yep. That's right.
So that's the equivalent of an FTE if we hadn't done it.
So the health inspector hours, you're pushing an increase there. I'm sorry, the building permit hours. Is there any correlation between, say there were like 1,000 permits?
Yep.
Is there any correlation between the number of permits issued and new growth? And as we anticipate new growth, the rate of that declining in the future, do you anticipate a correlation with permit activity and hours?
I don't think it would be new growth. I think it would be looking at the number of inspections, which we do track, and the number of permits. So as those two things increase, that's when we see the need for a few extra hours. And in this case, it's on the electrical inspector and the plumbing inspector.
Okay.
So they're busy. There's a lot of need for inspections. There's a lot of coordination with RMLD on new services, so all the new homes that are going in, all the new renovations. I mean, we're kind of in that mode where it's a busy construction season. It was something in the Globe today that was, you know, kind of shocking about how crazy the market is, and people can't even find a house to buy, never mind, you know, the prices out of sight. So everything is ratcheted way up on construction activity. And that's why we've shifted things around so that we have coverage on Friday because we don't want to hold up projects.
Right.
And that's what carried a couple of extra hours that we needed for the electrical and the plumbing inspectors. They were only part-time anyway, so
right.
I think they went from 19 to 21.
I just didn't know if at a high level, and I could be drawing the lines wrong, but the new growth, I think we have budgeted $500,000 this year.
I was going to say, the answer is kind of who knows, and it depends.
Okay.
You know, you can have one permit that's a huge project that generates a lot of new growth. You can have lots of small home renovations that generate almost nothing. So probably in the long run, the number of permits does correlate to the amount of new growth, but not at all in the short run.
Sure. Okay. Sorry, I had a couple more. Again, it's kind of a, higher level question, but I think you stated in here in the text somewhere about the demographics changing in the town, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just shift toward an older population.
Yes.
What, and I don't know what those numbers are and what the rate of increase is anticipated to be and all that, but can you talk a little bit about the impact on community service, particularly probably elder and human services,
mm-hmm.
the immediate impact, and then how you see that kind of playing out,
sure.
in line with demographic trends over the next several months, a year, 2 years?
Yep. That's exactly why we're engaged with UMass Boston, the Gerontology Institute, to carve out a master plan. We think we're staffed up in a way that we can be responsive to community needs. We have a full-time nurse advocate. That's a huge resource for that population, that vulnerable population that may need guidance on some things. We also have a full-time outreach worker, senior outreach worker, and they're working very collaboratively with public safety on all those things that happen below the radar screen, with things like hoarding, things like, you know, all the kinds of issues that they come across in public safety that they now are in partnership with our human services folks,
yeah.
to quietly go about solving those problems and getting people the resources that they need, probably beyond, definitely beyond what we can offer, but having that link.
Yeah.
The real question I think that you're asking, which is a good one, is what's it going to look like in a few years? We know we're trending an aging population.
And I don't know how quickly it's trending, so I don't know if it's
yeah.
a next year question or a 3 year
yeah.
question or.
I'm hoping I'll have a lot more data and a lot more information and a lot more guidance on that with the results of what UMass is working on. They're actually starting focus groups next week, I think, where they're going to sit down in a room with key community stakeholders and start talking about what are we doing as a community? Are we collaborating enough? Are there pockets of need that we're not collectively addressing? Where should we be focusing our energies? And then we're going to have a community forum to talk about it some more too.
Mm-hmm.
And then UMass goes through and looks at all the data and projects out what it's going to look like so that we're not reacting. We can actually do some planning. As a planner, I love planning, so I'm thrilled with it. And hopefully this time next year we'll have some good answers for
right.
you.
You feel that you're adequately staffed for this year?
I do,
given
the increases. Just like with the other divisions, I, you know, sit down with them on a regular basis and check in to say, you know, do you have the tools you need? And you know, everybody's so good about making it all work and not asking for a lot, which is great. But if we need to look beyond and plan, we're doing that, and I think that's important.
Just a quick, Mark was asking about some of the veterans. So how many veterans are in town that
you know,
BSO?
It's hard to say because
yeah.
that population, they don't necessarily come forward. They don't ask for anything. So some of the things that we do at community events, like I'll say the Fall Street Fair, the Veterans Agent has a booth at the Fall Street Fair. And you say, well, why would the Veterans Agent be at the Fall Street Fair? He meets a lot of people there that just happen to be walking around. And again, he quietly goes about figuring out if people need assistance through these programs, and that's how we work. And he goes to the senior center once a month, and he has a group down there that he just informally sits around the table with a cup of coffee, and it's that relationship building, it's that not formal process. You know, we don't send a letter out and say, are you a veteran? Because we never hear from them. They're people that have served their country and very proud. They're not looking for anything. But through these other avenues, we try and do the best we can to identify needs and match resources. And if things change, and sadly they wouldn't be eligible for those programs, we try and get that right too. So
Would you say that the number that you've been helping out has been increasing over the last few years?
I think it's been, I think it's been fairly steady. I don't, I mean, you know, some come on and then some come off, so it's kind of a moving target. But I think overall, it's probably about the same. But it's hard to say, again, you know, something could change and we could have a lot more. The good thing is the state pays such a big percentage of that, so we get reimbursed, which is really helpful.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Is the idea behind the application for the 40B hold that because Reading is moving forward with the project by the train station, we're making progress towards
yes.
our numbers? So okay.
Yes. We actually put together a housing production plan a few years ago. We said in the housing production plan, it's a requirement that communities have to meet the 10% state mandate of affordable housing. And it's a requirement that you have a plan for how you're going to get there. So it's a production plan. And in that production plan, we say, okay, we're going to have this project, we're going to add this many units, that many units, and we look into the crystal ball.
Mm-hmm.
And so they say, all right, well, if you can show, if you can make a 0.5% increase in a calendar year, we'll give you a reprieve. And that's if you can make half a percent, you get 1 year. If you make a 1%, you get a full 2 years. So we're shooting for the 1%.
Okay.
And we might get there. We have a plan. But you know what it's like to plan. It doesn't always go according to plan.
For those at home, can you describe what a 40B is?
Sure. So Mass General Law Chapter 40B, and thank you, because we're so guilty of using jargon all the time. My husband always says to me, can you please not talk that way? 40B is a law, Mass General Law, that allows developers to bypass local zoning and other regulations. Mostly the zoning is what rings true. So if you're not at 10%, they can come through what's called a comprehensive permit, apply to the zoning board. They still have to go through the permitting process and apply to the zoning board for a comp permit. And zoning has nothing to do with it. CPDC has nothing to do with it. I have no role. They can just go through the zoning board and present their project. It's a series of public hearings, and they don't have to go by zoning.
And 10% meaning 10% affordable housing?
10% of all the units, yeah, have to be affordable. And it's an interesting thing, because when you say affordable housing, you say, well, there's apartments over here, and we know that they don't charge a lot of rent, so that must be affordable housing. Well, it is, but we don't get credit for it unless it's deed restricted. So I used to work in a community where they had a lot of mobile homes, and we thought, well, that's affordable housing. And the state said, oh, no, unless you have a deed restriction attached to those mobile homes, you don't get credit for any of them. And we had 700 of them. So it's, you know, it's tricky. But the good news is that we did have a certified plan. We did have a roadmap for how to get there. And this 40B puts us over that 0.5%. Those units, the 68 units, gets us there. And I think having the ability to catch our breath on that would be really helpful. And if we can add to it, that's even better. Because it feels so strange to have projects go up that don't have to go by local zoning.
Right, and that bump up is mostly due to the area around the depot or Pulte Homes? Do we still call it Pulte?
Yeah, the 68 units, we get credit for all the units in that development.
Even if just a certain percent is actually
affordable. It's only 25% is affordable.
Yeah.
But because it's rental, we get full credit for all the units that are going in. So those 68 units for us are significant because it's above that 0.5%.
Are they all deed restricted?
The whole building
is.
Yeah, the deed for the building is all according to what the state wants. It's going to be so many and all the requirements. And so it's a strange thing that if it's rental, you get all the units.
So it's only if it's rental.
Rental.
Oh, I guess I didn't know that.
Yeah. And then so there's another one coming. The St. Agnes Church is being, the school building is being developed. under 40B. The zoning board just received that application, and that's 20 units. So that's where we're kind of trending, you know, that we can now add that to our inventory, and we might be able to achieve that two-year reprieve.
And on the places that are rental, and only 25% are actually low.
Yep.
Is that 25% a magic number?
Yes, that's
okay.
Required by the
that's
state.
That's 25% is already passed.
Yeah.
Anything else, folks? Good. All right. Thanks,
all right.
Jean.
Thanks very
much.
Thank
you. Matt, I think you're next.
I guess I'm up.
Mm-hmm.
Hot seat.
Not very hot.
Not very hot.
Just the outside.
It's nice. Good evening, everybody.
Hey.
Hi. Good to see everybody again. Eric had a good idea. He emailed me and asked for a copy of the org chart, so I did provide him with one, but through the chair, I brought copies for the Finance Committee, if it's okay for me to submit
please.
Those.
Please. Yeah,
time.
Great.
So just maybe you can. I should actually keep one for myself, too.
Oh.
Thank you. And the only, there's not many changes to the budget this year, and the only thing different on the org chart from last year is the purchasing agent, and we've hired a full-time purchasing agent now to work for the town. That's working out well. She also does work for the school. But besides that, all of the people that were in place last year are in place again this year. We've been lucky to retain good staff in our department, and we hope that continues. So I thought I'd just go through some of the major changes in the budget and then answer any questions that you had, and I should be fairly brief with this. So administrative services budget, as you probably know, is divided into five divisions. There's operations, town manager, human resources, technology, and town clerk and elections. And overall, the budget is level funded. There is a small increase in expenses, a small decrease in salaries. And I'll go through the different divisions now and actually highlight some of those for you. So if we start with the operations division, and that division is the centralized location for procurement, communications, constituent services, shared staff, postage, equipment maintenance. We're proposing a $20,000 cut to the operations specialist position, going from $40,000 to $20,000. And that position is actually a shared position shared by our retired HR director and town accountant. They're both retired, so we'd be cutting back some of their hours. That's actually, we're counting that as a reduction of half an FTE. As you go further down the operations budget, you'll see that we're cutting $23,000 from the pay and class line item. So this means there won't be any pay and class funding in the 2018 budget for this year, for next year. We actually consider that a reduction of a FTE as well, or half of an FTE. And we're also making some reductions to temporary help. So that's a 15% cut. And that's mostly high school students that help us out during the year. And that will hurt us a little bit, but not too much, as it's just a temporary position. If we move on to the town manager's budget, that includes selectmen, finance committee, legal services, property insurance. And we're actually asking for an increase in that budget for legal counsel. So that line is hopefully going up, and that seems to be trending in that direction, and that's why we're asking for that. Also, with procurement coming on full-time under my budget, we're doing a lot of contract reviews that require town council to look at, and like I said, it's shared with the schools as well. So that would be an increase, but we're actually decreasing the town manager's reserve fund, which is used for small costs and projects as well. So there'll be a decrease there.
Give me just one sec, Matt, and
yeah.
Maybe it's a question for Sharon also. Are we locked into the cost of the audit? Was that contractually laid out for multiple years? So that it is what it is. There's no negotiating.
Yeah, no.
3 years?
I think it was 3 years. I think it was signed last year.
Yeah,
yeah.
I think so too. Okay.
And
too bad. Excuse me.
That's okay. So that's the only real change in the town manager budget. As we move on to human resources, obviously, this division supports the town, the schools, also supports the light department and retirees as well. So they have their hands in a lot of different areas with the town.
We're making a large cut to professional services, but that line item was funded mostly because we needed a lot of assessment centers last year where we had a opening for deputy fire chief and for police chief. This year we're not looking at that type of assessment center, so we are asking just to make that cut in that line item. And really everything else is pretty much level services in human resources. We do have a human resource generalist that started last year and is shared with the schools as well. And we try to create as much synergy with the schools as we can, share resources. So in human resources and in procurement, that happens quite a bit. Also in technology, which is a larger budget. In technology, we provide centralized computer telecommunication services, as well as internet, audio, visual, software. Anything you can imagine technology would cover, we cover. We are asking for an increase there. Our Microsoft, we're actually for a $40,000 increase expense to upgrade our Microsoft Office software that we use for the town. Right now we're running Office 10. We want to upgrade to Office 16. And the issue there is we're having some compatibility issues with the older software. So we're hoping to have that funded. I know Bob in his messages put that as a holdback for the schools, but we're hoping that that does get funded eventually during fiscal 18. And there's also a one-time $30,000 expense to acquire rugged field tablets for the DPW. So as they're out and they're doing their jobs on the road, they can have tablets, and they have to be sturdier than the normal tablets that we all carry around. So that's an expense there. And we also asked for a one-time expense for our firewall, which according to our technology director needs to be replaced. And we don't want to get an issue with the firewall doesn't work. So that's something we really hope to get. As we move to town clerk and elections, this division obviously includes elections, voter registration, census, town meeting licenses, historical documents, document storage. And we're asking for an add there of $15,000 for electronic archiving. And that's something we really should be doing, is archiving a lot of our historic records. We do use Laserfiche to archive some of our more routine records, but this actually is more of an expense because it has to be taken care of historically. So we're asking for the $15,000 there. And again, I think Bob has held that back for the schools if needed, but it's in the budget. And we have a large cut in election workers this year because we have fewer elections, essentially, which saves us like $50,000, which is great. We'll probably hit a year again where it's going to increase by that amount, but at least for this year, we're in good shape there. So that reduction, we're counting that as a reduction of an FTE, actually 1.5 FTEs. So in the whole budget, we're actually, reducing, I think, by 2.5 FTEs if you add up everything that I've told you. And generally the department runs well. I'd be interested actually in your feedback in the budget that you see before you tonight. Is it a different format? And we've made that change. Our business administrator had come up with that change, and Bob obviously had a lot of input into it. We've gone away from the Munis sheets. We still use them internally, but for the FinCom and for town meeting, we thought it was actually better to have something a little more straightforward and not a lot of, you don't need the Oregon object number or all that stuff in there. So it is more of a communications document. This is what we've come up with, and we'd appreciate any feedback there, as you see, if you wanted to make any changes. But I think it's an improvement. You think so? Oh, great. Good.
And I like the idea of trying to be consistent between school and town, because it does help anyone look at the budget to understand how, the general structure and stuff. I think
exactly.
And I've never been a big Munis person.
Yeah.
If you don't tell me what you're really doing, I'm not going to go through numbers and go, did you really do that? To me, that's not our job. It's to the...
No, that's true, and Munis works great for us on the back end,
course,
but
right.
For the general public, not a lot of people understand
it. The budget looks great.
Right. So I mean, that's a real brief overview, but I'm happy to answer any questions either on the org chart or on the budget itself or anything I discussed, and take it from there.
So one comment. I too like this format.
Mm-hmm.
It would be great to be able to look at FTEs easily by department or group. That would really help us understand. Some, even still, there's some lump numbers that we could break down by understanding FTEs and what's going on.
Yeah, we could work on that. It's actually hard to get a way to calculate accurately the FTEs. We're working on that because there's people that share jobs. There's people that work part time. We can get a pretty round number with that, but you're right. If we had a more exact number, that would be helpful. So that's something we'll work on.
And it'll make it easier to see changes also.
Yeah,
Adds and subtracts, which would be very helpful.
Just one minor suggestion. I thought it was very easy to digest and read, so I appreciate the change. It was great.
Thanks.
It might be personal preference. I love to see not only FY18 budget percent change, but dollar change. That helps me scan right down through and just see where the... And I don't know if you're manually building these tables or if you're lifting them out of some software. I don't know how hard a change that is.
Mostly
to make,
Excel.
But,
so,
yeah, okay.
Yeah. So dollar change as well?
It's my personal preference, anyway, for what it's worth.
Okay.
I agree, because sometimes, you know, 50% change,
right. No, it does. Yeah, you have to go back and look and see what it is. Okay, that's good. Those are good suggestions.
You mentioned moving the election or elections in excess of one to the accommodated.
Just
to smooth out the variability.
Right. Yeah, that was in the, and we put that in the narrative, and I was talking to the town manager about that, and we thought it's so variable every year, you know, if we did move it in at least one election a year into accommodated cost, because it does benefit everybody, that might make it a little more, you know, predictable and a little easier on the town clerk budget. We haven't done that yet, but
yeah, certainly smooth it out, but
right.
I didn't know whether one was the right number or two.
In terms of elections?
Yeah, it's like every other year we have two, right?
Yeah, well, we definitely have the one. We always have at least one a year. Every other year we have two. We could move to two, yeah. Right.
I think Bob has a comment on that.
Just every year, in theory, maybe every 2 or 3 years in practice, discuss this with schools. What should be accommodated costs? What should? We'll probably do it again this year for sure. We didn't do it last time. We were busy with other things. A logical answer is there is one local election every year. That should be in your budget. Variable part, the unpredictable part sometimes is other elections. You'd be surprised that, well, in addition to calling for an override, there are sometimes, if you will, snap election at the state or federal level because someone has left a job or passed away in a job and there has to be an election. So in some of those cases, it's impossible. But the theory of accommodating costs were to reduce volatility. That was one of the things. And even when we know there's, you know, a presidential election every 4 years, it's still volatile. So it's a theoretical question. So I just raised it in the text and I've talked about it with the schools, and we'll revisit it this summer. Just to jump ahead a little bit, I'm not sure that the cemetery division, DPW, should be accommodated costs forever or in the future. And we've kicked that idea around because its costs year aside or next year aside are just like any other DPW division. The reason that was an accommodated cost originally was because its source of funding was different. A lot of the funds were not general funds. They were from the cemetery trust funds or funds. So again, I think the accommodated costs are an open topic this year. Some of the discussion came up at some of the school committee meetings. Every year I dare them to, you know, stop doing it that way do it the old way, and that's a market timing thing. So this year, their out-of-district special ed costs went down quite a bit. They wished they were not an accommodated cost, and they could have kept all that money themselves. Other years, they've gone up a lot. They're glad. So none of this is perfect. The theory was to use common sense, identify reasons why things should not be part of an operating budget. Some of them are obvious, health insurance. I mean, there's no department that's really in charge of that. Capital debt, same thing. The cost of energy and facilities was always thought to be variable. Since we started this method over 10 years ago, I have to say energy costs are a lot better behaved. And I'm sorry, Joe, now they won't. That always happens. But it's something that really should be revisited with FinCom's input, I think, this summer. I just put the issues all out there, the good, the bad, and come to whatever conclusion we come to. As I've said to the superintendent almost every year, whatever the community wants to do is fine. We just have to understand the reasons, understand the rules, and then off we go. And you should always be willing to change. If something works well, you keep it. If it doesn't work well, you change. So I would say for the summer, it seems reasonable that Matt's budget will always fund one election. Beyond that, I'd say it's a discussion.
Matt, I noticed that, I guess the state treasurer, or other treasurer, noted that they figured out what the extra costs of early voting were. Are we going to get the money back?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no. I think it's like $4,000 or $5,000, I think.
I thought it was more substantial, no?
It was like 50, it was 5,000 or something, I thought, I think it was.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I thought too. I'll check with the town clerk on that. That
no, unless we join a lawsuit.
Yeah,
well, 350 other communities do, we should too.
Yeah, well, it's because of the unfunded mandate law, and you, a couple of towns have pushed for that money and joined that suit. I haven't been told by town council that we want to do that, but for that amount of money. You know.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
There's a law out there that says if they declared an unfunded mandate, you could actually go after that money.
Right.
You have to go through.
But you
the
have
process.
To chase it.
Right.
They don't just send it to you in the mail.
Exactly. Yeah. No, they won't. I wish they would. If it were as simple as them just sending it to us, yes. But they make us jump through a few hoops there. So.
I thought maybe something was going to be easy at the state level. My mistake.
No. I wish it was.
Other questions, Eric?
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Just a couple of minutes.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. On the 40,000 increase in the legal.
Yeah.
I certainly understand. There was a phrase in the narrative, actually I can't remember if it was here, that the selectman's
okay.
Said it should be considered permanent. I didn't know what that, precisely that phrase meant.
In terms of the legal increase, should
yeah.
be considered permanent?
Yeah.
I can answer that because I remember saying at a selectman's meeting, sorry Matt. No,
yeah, that's okay. It's up to you.
See,
Bob
you
said it.
To me for a long time. I didn't have to pay it for it. TLT is not what I would consider a permanent. Funding in this budget has nothing to do with TLT, the increase. The run rate right now of non-TLT legal expenses is somewhere between 180 and 190, so it seemed quite reasonable that 200 is a good number for next year. One of the reasons, as Gene mentioned, is 40B applications are expensive. You'll see a town meeting transfer request at April that you'll see in a couple weeks. It's not a big number. It's 10 or 15,000 we used for 40B legal consulting services, but that's not a number you can budget. What we need to now start thinking about budgeting for, even if we get the 1 year off, those are real costs. What we have discovered in the last few years is the town has some very, very old policies, more than 25 years old. We've tried to update some of them. Invariably, it gets into legal issues and things have changed. Whether it's HR, or whether it's personnel or something else. It just seems like in the past we've spent $30,000 and $40,000 a year on legal services and we kicked the can down the road and all of a sudden you find out what it really cost you not to be spending the $100,000 or $200,000. So I would have to say I would consider this increase permanent. It doesn't mean we'll spend it every year, I hope. But it's unreasonable to think we're going to go back to 100,000 unless it's a strategy and we say, you know, we can do a lot more on our own. Matt's actually a lawyer. You know, we could do more.
Don't tell me.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry.
It's okay. Yeah.
Could you explain the 40B legal? How's that work? What do we? What's
when you go through a 40B,
yeah.
you have a right to have peer counseling, legal counseling. Long and short of it was, the state provided us a lawyer for one night and we asked him to perform. We used our own. There's a lot of reasons for that I can't discuss. We believe we get much better service under our town council, who is exclusively looking out for Reading's interests, period. There is some question on the train depot whether we can bill the applicant to the 10 or 15,000. We haven't really discussed it. My opinion, and it's only my opinion, is that project made so many changes compared to how they came into town. And believe me, Gene will never tell you, the staff worked enormously long hours to make those changes, along with two of our selectmen. I'm not looking to chase them for 10 grand, honestly. But the next 40B, we have to spend 10 or 15,000, and it's a very adversarial relationship, and it's not a good end result, and yeah, we'll chase them.
Right, so it says you're working out the details, that's what you tend to then get lawyers for, to
so
represent
we
you.
So we have legal representation at every single public meeting for the 40B CPA. Which is 10 or 12. Plus, in between, all sorts of questions and dialogue. Reading used to be proud that it would spend 40,000 and our peers are spending 300,000. There's a certain amount of pride there that was justified, but I think it was a little short-sighted.
Mm-hmm.
There's a reason why your peers are spending 250, 300, 350. We could still do maybe a little less than that, but you know, to me, town council is a really good defense against future problems. We happen to, I think, have hired an excellent group to. So sorry.
I agree with everything Bob said.
I'm the one that tends to interact directly with town council,
yeah,
so Matt doesn't do it as much.
Right. But and it's important to remember that administrative services as a whole serves the whole town. So even though it shows up in my budget, we may use them for procurement and from other reasons, but a lot of other departments use him even more, like zoning. So that's what the increase.
So quick question. How much of that budget, the 200, is specialty outside council versus town council?
Zero
is outside. It's
yeah,
all town. It's all.
Right. We have a labor council that's a separate line item.
Right.
But that's he keeps everything in the house. I haven't remembered since I've been here.
Yeah. Again, Matt, this spring will ask for special counsel for cable negotiations.
Right. Yeah.
That's really special.
So TLT, labor, and cable are the only specialty that we would use or have.
In most towns, if I remember correctly, do use outside counsel as opposed to hiring inside. Is that still true?
It depends on the town. Some towns, I mean, definitely the larger cities, a lot of them have a city solicitor in-house and they'll farm out
right.
certain cases. The smaller towns generally use outside counsel. It's just more cost-effective. You don't have to pay the personnel costs. You're maybe not using them as much as a larger city would. So that's what I've seen, smaller towns and mid-sized towns. Not so much having an inside in-house
yeah.
counsel.
Is there? I know there's a point. At what point do you start to say, we're teetering on, you know, maybe it's going to cost less to have a full-time inside person?
We can look at it. I think probably right now it's more cost-effective to farm it out to have the outside counsel because of the employment costs. But if it keeps on etching up, you may want to have a combination of an inside counsel here and farm out certain work that they're not. It's not their expertise. But that hasn't, I don't think that's ever been the tradition in Reading, as far as I know. So, and this is working very well. We have a really good law firm.
Yeah,
and they're very accessible, right on the money, so.
If I could just add that the model looks the same over the many years, but the big change has been the firm we're at now is larger than our past firms, and we tend to use 4 to 6 lawyers on a regular basis.
Right.
In the past, especially 3 town councils ago, it was one person. So then the discussion's a little cleaner. Well, we're using this person for this much cost, this many hours. Now we're getting, you know, kind of variable support.
Good.
It's a fair point if it's something to always keep
yeah.
your eye on.
And they kind of specialize within their own law firm, too. So there's somebody that does procurement law for them, somebody that specializes in zoning. But you get all that, you know,
yeah.
where if you had one lawyer here, they may not be an expert in all those things, and they'd be finding things out even more. So
Ray is just the face.
Well, no, he's definitely the guy running it. He's got a lot of good lawyers there working for him too.
So
yeah,
Jean,
no,
you
I just wanted to say what a pleasure it's been working with ERS and Harrington. The work that we've done is very, very technical, and the zoning in particular. I've worked with other, you know, law firms that don't go as deep as this firm does, specifically in zoning, and that's a portion of the law that you really have to get right, and we've had to deal with, you know, medical marijuana and just really things that are happening and changing quickly that we've had to respond to, and they've been excellent. So I can't say enough about what a pleasure it is to work with them.
And we pay them for actual use, right? That's the structure. It's
right.
It's not a retainer.
No, they bill us. Yeah.
Yeah.
We pay them. Okay.
Sorry, Eric, I interrupted you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I'm just going to change topics.
Okay.
HR, in the narrative, Matt, you note that the HR field is becoming more complex due to rapidly changing state and federal requirements. What kind of pressure is that placing on your resource? I assume it's alleviated a bit with the generalist.
Yeah.
What kind of pressure is that placing on the resources now, and how do you see that increasing down the road, short-term, long-term? Is that...
Yeah, if we didn't have the generalist, we'd be in rough shape right now. That once we hired that person, his name is Sean Donahue, it took a lot of stress off Judy, our HR director, and he has a lot of expertise as well, so he adds to the department. And also, he's at the school department a couple days a week as well. So there's a lot of synergy between us and the schools, and we bounce things off one another. I think right now we're in a good position to handle it. I have HR background as well, and I'm a lawyer, so I help out as well a lot in HR to keep up with everything. But I don't see it right now as a need to hire any more staff there. You know, we have three staff there, you know, one shared, and we get the job done. So we'll keep an eye on it in the future, though, if things, if there's a need.
No, I was thinking last year it was sort of a theme to consolidate more the procurement.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to hear how that was going. Do we feel we've got some good economies of scale?
Yeah, no, I think we did. So we consolidated procurement, and it took us a little while. At this time last year, I don't think we had hired the procurement officer as of yet. But now we have, and she's great. She was doing it for another town and came here and really hit the ground running. So that's worked out great, and I know that she's working with facilities, with the school department, with other departments, DPW, to get things done. And I think it adds not only economy of scale, but also, you know, an extra level in there to make sure that we're doing things right, and we're not running afoul of any of the procurement laws. And
that was our focus too.
Yes,
yeah.
And there are other people within the town that are also certified in procurement. The assistant DPW director that used to do procurement for us is still, Jane actually is still here. And also there's another Jane Miller, who's the business administrator that recently got certified as well. So we're really strong, I think, in procurement now, and I think having that unified department made a lot of sense. We finalized a procurement handbook for all the departments to use, and I don't know if you guys saw it, but it's about a 30-page handbook that walks everybody through the process, and if there's any issues, they can call us, and we've developed some new forms. So I think we're in a real strong place there with procurement, and it has been a savings.
Right. And then what's the opposite of procurement when we're trying to get rid of staff?
The opposite? Oh, like surplusing things? Or?
Yeah.
Yeah,
so
that comes up with procurement.
I was like, what was the word?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That was the other piece that we're...
Right.
That was the other piece we wanted.
Yeah, right, and we've done it. We actually at the library, because they had to get rid of so much stuff when they moved. Mm-hmm. We put a lot of there's a website called GovDeals, and our procurement office put a lot of the stuff there, and people bought it and picked it up, and so the surplusing angle of it is it's still under procurement. It's still something that's very needed. Mm-hmm. We're looking at the policy. We have a bylaw on it right now that's not very well worded, and I spoke to the bylaw committee about this, and we might actually get rid of the bylaw and replace it with just a policy that gives us a little more flexibility. So that may be something that's coming in the future. FinCom would still have a role in that, as would town meeting. It would just give us a little more flexibility. If we want to change it, we don't have to go through the bylaw after that. And a lot of towns do it that way. We've done
mm-hmm.
a survey, so.
They do a little bit more, it's flexible and dynamic.
Yeah, exactly.
Thanks, Matt.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
See you next year.
Yeah. See you next year. Maybe a few other meetings.
Yeah.
I'll be pretty brief. Not a lot of interesting stuff to talk about finance, but I will be, after I give the update on the finance budget, giving you some background on the retirement board's article that they're going to present at the April town meeting. As the town accountant, I have to act as ex officio on the retirement board, and they are asking something of town meeting, so I want to brief you on what that is. So I'll get to that at the end. So the finance department budget is on page 43 through 46 of your packet. question it for myself, just in case. And so the finance department is made up of the three divisions, accounting, assessing, and finance. There's about 12 to 13 people there. We have some not full FTEs in there. And the budget for finance is up 1.83%, and that's primarily driven by salary increases. So the staff in finance is all non-union staff, and they're getting a step and a 0.75 COLA, which is what's been recommended by the town manager. The finance department did not lose any staff from the reductions that Bob had proposed, which is great because the volume and nature of the work that we do is not going to be reduced by our financial situation. And there's quite a bit of volume. The other thing to consider too when you think about the finance department is we do for the entire town. So water, sewer, stormwater, RMLD, we're collecting all that money. We're billing things out for water and sewer and stormwater. We're billing the real estate taxes. We're paying the payroll. We're doing all the financial functions that are still going to happen. And we do it for not just the town side, but the enterprise funds as well. And we charge support back to those enterprise funds for those services. So they pay a portion of our salaries and our expenses. So if you were to cut a person out of the finance department, because it's kind of a shared service kind of department, you wouldn't get the whole salary savings in the general fund because other funds are actually helping to pay for some of the support that's there. So I figured that'd be important to note. Also,
sorry, so how does that flow? So this budget we look at
is 100% what the salaries are. But when you look at the budget that we show for revenues, you'll see a line that says enterprise support. And that any department that is kind of supporting an enterprise fund, some of their salaries
so
is being charged back to them.
The revenue.
Yeah, so you'd only see it in the revenue. It's not
revenue.
Offsetting
yeah.
anywhere where you could see it.
It
in a department. And finance is one of the departments. But just like technology would be a department, town manager would be a department that would share some of his salaries, and you don't really see it, it's almost invisible to you.
Because it's just a revenue.
Because it's one number you see in our revenues, and it's enterprise support.
No offsets within these.
No offsets.
Does RMLD contribute to
they
it as well?
They contribute as well.
Correct.
Because we do for them as well, so yeah,
right.
We absolutely do. And the one thing that we are picking up next year that we hadn't been doing prior is the senior tax relief. We did not add any staff for that. We plan to absorb it with existing staff the best we can. Because it's tight financial times. And I think that we can do it without any real issue. I mean, because of the simplicity of the process of determining qualification, it really is. If you got the circuit breaker on your taxes and you can prove that to us, then you can qualify. And when you look through the budget for the finance department, there's maybe three lines that actually increase over the prior year. Two are in the accounting professionals development area by $100 each, very minimal increase there. And the third is actually the regional assessor. He is actually an employee of Wakefield, and we pay them under contract, and that goes up 3.1%. Other than that, none of our expenses are going up. And so overall, the budget goes up about 1.83%, and that's essentially driven by the salary increase, really. Not a lot going on there. So if you guys have questions about finance, I can answer those, and I can move on to the retirement article.
Questions? No, very button-down.
Any update on the senior tax credit? Because that goes through the state, right? It's gotta get
I haven't heard anything, Bob. Do you know? For legislative approval?
Governor signed.
They approved,
did.
Yeah.
Yeah, the AG has not yet approved our November town meeting. That item went a different path. That's one little petition.
Yeah.
So the legislatures, both sides voted, and the governor signed it sometime in January.
So we're.
And that's effective.
So it will be going.
It'll start being advertised to the public probably in April or May, and then August, September is the busy period.
Wow, that's faster than we anticipated, right? Didn't we think it might be up to 2 years?
Well, we knew that it could happen this way.
Right.
We weren't sure if it would
okay.
happen for this. It has to be an annual thing. So if it didn't happen this fast, we'd have to wait a year.
So I'm having them pass around the three pages related to the article that retirement is asking for April town meeting. This had been on the November town meeting, and we ended up tabling it because we had some questions of the actuary. She gave us an idea of how much it increases our overall liability long term, and we were like, how do you get to that number? This is a small change. So we wanted to wrap our minds around that, and so we postponed it until April, and it will be in effect if it's approved July 1st, 2017. So what they're essentially asking is for town meeting to approve an increase of the COLA base. Right now the COLA base is 12,000 and they want to increase it to 14,000. And what that means is when a retiree is collecting a pension from the retirement system, if their pension is more than $12,000, they're only getting a COLA on the first $12,000. So their increase is the 3% of $12,000. So they get $360 a year increase for COLA if they get the 3%. And that COLA base has not been changed since 1998. And some other communities, as you can see on the chart, are still at 12,000. Others have changed to different amounts. And we are able to go up in $1,000 increments per the statute. And you can see that some are much higher, some are higher, some are lower, but we haven't changed it since 1998. And so on the second sheet that I provided you, I kind of break out for you what the current picture looks like in terms of how many retirees we have. We have 332 retirees. 77 of our retirees actually have pensions that are lower than $12,000. So this change would not give them any additional in their checks. So it's not going to affect
them. Could you say those numbers again? So
77 retirees, and it's actually in your second sheet here. 77 do not get any change by this change. And then 18 retirees have pensions that range between 12,000 and 14,000, so they'll get some portion of this additional $60. Because if we go to 14,000 as proposed, they get 3% of the 14,000. Now it's 420. It's a $60 a year increase, essentially $5 more a month for each retiree maximum per month. So they're really only getting $60 more a year. But like I said, the 77 people who are 12,000 or less, they won't see anything additional. 18 people will see something close to $60, depending on where they sit, and then 237 of the retirees will fully qualify for the full $60 that they're proposing. And in fiscal 18, it will cost roughly $15,300, somewhere in that vicinity. And I got that number assuming all of the people, all the 18, actually get the full 60, knowing that they may not get the full 60. So when we were looking at this number, we're like, this is a pretty small change. But when we had the actuary take a look at what does this increase our long-term liability, even though it looks small,
right.
What's the end number? And when you look at the back page, this is what she told us when we were giving our options. An increase of to 14,000 actually brings us to a liability increase of $1.5 million. So that's kind of a tough pill to swallow. We haven't increased it since 1998. It's worth an ask at town meeting to see how people feel about it. If they say no, then they go back to the drawing board. One good thing to mention is that the assessment that the town is currently paying is assuming that we already did this. And so it won't change the assessment that's already out there that we've paid for fiscal 16 or what will be paid in fiscal 17. The actuary built her numbers based on us having it at the 14,000 that we're proposing. For fiscal 16, we didn't get it voted by town meeting, so it didn't go into play. But in fiscal 17, it's already in there. And if we don't end up paying it, it just ends up being when she's doing her revaluation again. Like, they make a lot of assumptions when they do an actuary evaluation. They assume, you know, a certain life expectancy, a certain age, people retire. There's a lot of things built into that. And some of it is like the salary increases that we would receive. Maybe she might assume that we'll get 4%, and then she realizes that maybe we got 2, you know. There's a lot of gains that she reevaluates it after she looks at it again. She will look at it again next year. So if we don't do it, it's built in there, and it probably will just get confused against all the other liability that's out there. It doesn't extend out the date that will be fully funded, which is 2029. It was 2028, but the reason for it being pushed out had nothing to do with this, really. It was really mostly to do with the fact that we updated the mortality table, which was in need of an increase, and then we also decreased what we thought our discount rate should be. So we had added like a, I think it was 8%, and we went down to 7.75%, trying to be conservative and bring it down if we can, because, you know, if you don't get those returns, you can have a loss, you know. So whatever she's assuming for our return on investment, she wants to keep it at a conservative number. We have been achieving what we've been projecting on the valuation, but markets change, and I think she just prefers we'd be a little more conservative. And she actually wanted us to go down to 7.5, but would have pushed us out a little further. We're trying to keep close to that 2028, 2029 to get that fully funded pension. So this doesn't change that date at all. It's already been worked into that date. So I just wanted to make sure we hadn't realized before when we were going to show it in November that we should brief FinCom. It just didn't occur to anybody at the retirement board. I'm like, I can brief them. I'm going to be presenting my finance budget. I can explain this to them so they can vote on if they agree with it or not, give them the facts and whatever they feel. And so I figured I would use this forum of me doing my budget to give you this information, and you can take it and read it and think about it, and then you can decide when they vote on the articles how you feel about it. Does
sure.
anybody have any questions?
Yeah, please. Can you translate from the first presentation page where it talks about the fiscal 18 increases to
$15,000? I know,
$15,
yeah. Thank you.
Where was it?
So on your second sheet you gave us at the bottom, it says total 332 retirees, fiscal 18 increase $15,300.
So we originally had hoped to get this in the November town meeting and make it retroactive and have it for the whole year of fiscal 16 or fiscal 17. And we didn't actually get it to town meeting for November because we tabled it because we were very shocked by the valuation number we got from our actuary. And so we wanted to make sure the numbers we gave were accurate, and so we tabled it. Now we're thinking, okay, we're not going to go retroactive. We're going to make this for fiscal 18 starting July 1st, 2017. So the way I arrived at the 15,300 is I said, okay, there's 77 people who are getting nothing if we make this change. There's 18 people that stand to get up to $60 a year. And then there's 237 people who will definitely get the $60. And that's how I arrived at that number. I did the math and came up with the 15,300.
Now, can you take that 15,300 and make that turn into 209,000? And if you can, I have some other things I want you to do.
Well, I think that the reason she's telling you that is that we only have so many years left until we're fully funded, and so it's chewing it up and trying to catch us up for all the years that this, you know, because this is going to be in place for...
Oh, because our liability took a big jump.
Yeah, yeah. And we're putting this in place, and we want to be fully funded by 2029, so we're trying to get back on that timeline. And this is going to cut the number here that she's giving us, the $1.5 million, is also considering the fact that there's going to be more retirees in the future. Every year you're going to get this full increase, so you
mm-hmm.
give them $60 this year, and then their pension's $60 higher, and then you're going to give them another $60. So it really compounds on itself, so it's really kind of confusing when you think about it. So you're like, it's $15,000. How does it turn into $1.5 million? And so we needed to wrap our mind around it and do the actuary math ourselves
mm-hmm.
to understand it. We feel comfortable it's accurate. It's not a pretty number. It's what's real, though. And so it's really up to town meeting and Chief FinCom what you guys think about that. And if they say no, we just live with the 12,000. But it just hasn't been increased in years. And they thought it was time to ask, because we usually table it when we talk about it with the actuaries. And every actuary says, well, others are, you can afford this. Why aren't you doing it? Why aren't you increasing this COLA base? And we're always trying to get to that fully funded, and making changes like this can actually change things and push things out, and we've not asked since 1998 because we just didn't want to push out that fully funded. But they evaluate
we can afford this how based on that.
Well, based on our returns and all that, and the date that we actually wanted to be fully funded, which is 2028. We were very close to staying in 2028, just got kind of pushed out 1 year just by a few assumptions that she had to change, the mortality table and our discount rate. She changed a few things that kind of pushed it out, and she said this had very little impact on it. But it still was hard for us to digest the numbers. We need to understand them. If we're going to go up on town meeting and say this is what it is, it's a $5 increase for each retiree a month, or $60 a year, and it sounds like a small amount, but it does in the long term have a big price tag on it. And if we're going to share that, we've got to share what the number is the actuary gave with us. So I really thought it would be a smaller number. I'm like, I just don't get it. Can we talk about this again? Like,
well,
so we
that
really
million
spent
and
a lot.
Half is really spread over.
Yeah,
years,
it's
so
really
it's
the current retirees,
yeah.
the future
yeah.
retirees, and it's
yeah.
expecting that they're getting this every year, because
yeah.
once you give it to them, you can't take it away.
Mm-hmm.
You can't revoke it. Once you say, okay, the COLA base is now 14, you can't take it back. And so every year they will get that COLA increase on 14 now instead of 12.
Right.
house. I never knew there were co-livings for retirees.
I didn't know until I was on the retirement board.
Okay, I thought it was me.
So I don't think most people do know.
Yeah.
I mean, I think people think, oh, you get a COLA every year, and they probably assume you get it on your whole pension, but you don't.
So will this affect when it's fully funded?
She said the changes that she made before she did the mortality changes, like if she did left everything alone, it didn't make changes to the mortality table, which is a more updated table, and changing the discount rate, we would have still been on the same date, the 2028. It was only when she improved the mortality table and changed our discount rate that slightly pushed us over to the next year. And we wanted to stay within a 4.5% increase each year. So with those numbers, she slightly went into the 2029. So, and it didn't change before she did that. So she's saying you can afford to do this and still stay in that timeline. But then she's like, let's talk about, some of the things we could change. The other thing that she changed that she had been assuming a very high increase for salary increases for our employees, and we never really had that. Those types of increases. I mean, she might have 5 or 6%, but that's not the type of increases we'd have. But they put conservative numbers in there. The prior firm that we had used very conservative numbers, and it would offset against other losses you'd have if you have a gain in one area, kind of offsets. And so it was kind of helpful to have. But she recommended really kind of make it closer to what it really is, And so she did reduce some of our assumptions about the increases in salary wages, because the number they were, we never see those percentages that they were plugging in to get to the number for us. So,
so just to be clear, the actuary's definition of affordable isn't necessarily our definition of affordable.
Exactly.
Their definition is, well, you said you want to be fully funded by X, and with the assumptions that they've changed, it's still roughly half.
Well, I think she feels like others have increased this and we've never changed it, and we could afford it within that, a very small change in our assessment.
Right.
And it was not a very big number in her opinion. And so she's
right.
We can put this in there and it doesn't even change the date.
But I think that's the point. Their definition of affordability is within the actuarial.
Everybody's going to have a different, yeah, exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
That may not be our definition of affordability at all. We disagree with that completely.
You can. Absolutely. I mean, also, too, actuaries put a lot of assumptions out there that are conservative and maybe very high to get to their number, just to protect themselves, that they're giving, numbers that they can safely assume are not too low. So, like I said, she puts a lot of estimates in that are different from what I know, and that's a conservative approach.
Okay.
She had to bring them down because I'm like, we're not even close to some of the things they were putting in, and we had that, leverage.
Do we know what the return on the retirement accounts are? How much they're?
I think they're over 8.
Over 8.
So we've always gotten more than what she has put in for an assumption for return. But the market can change. And she's like, you're lucky when you do get those returns.
Yeah. And they got 8 last year.
I'd have to look back, but I believe they're coming to
Wait,
do a presentation.
Get,
well, no, it makes sense if it's in S&P.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's what we have.
But it's in bonds as well. It's not all stocks.
Right. It's going to be
diversified. It's invested with PRIT.
It's invested what?
With PRIT.
Oh, okay.
Is the $1.5 million present value? Is that when you're talking about the discount?
Yes.
And so you said they changed the rate. Do you know based on what?
Well, she was just trying to be more conservative when she changed the discount rate to 7.75. So if we happen to have a lull year, we've got a little more wiggle room in terms of what actually is compared to what her assumption is.
If I can make a suggestion, this is a pretty complicated set of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
If this ends up going in front of town meeting,
mm-hmm.
It might be very helpful to explain exactly where this is coming from,
mm-hmm.
since it seems like a tremendous amount of money that we want to make clear is not part of the budget process. And I would also suggest leading with the positive as far as what extending the timeline or time frame for it being fully funded and what that means and
mm-hmm.
how and what the effect is.
I mean, the plan was to show something more like this to just give them an idea and then mention what the liability increase would be. This sheet is what she gave us, and I thought it would help you to see what we were looking at when she said, well, these are your choices and how much it will change your unfunded liability.
It's informative, it's shocking when we go from 15,000 to...
Well, that's why we tabled it. We were like, how do you get there? We're not understanding how you got there. And even one of our board members is an actuary, and he's like, you need to walk me through this. Like, how do we have a $15,000 change in 1 year, and then it turns into 1.5? But it's the compounding. It's the getting it every year. It's the, you know, the future, the
retirees,
all the retirees that
yeah.
will be, not just the
yeah.
ones that currently are. There's
and
so much more that goes
into
it.
Paying that catch up because we're trying to keep the date the same.
Yes.
Basically.
Yeah.
So
because
it's
we want to not extend it out to do this.
More concentrated.
So it's a shorter time frame
yeah.
you're trying to get this fully funded in. So.
I think to Vanessa's point, I think the above average person won't understand this.
Okay.
So the average person, I think, has no chance. There's got to be some way to kind of portray what's happening and why.
Well, the person who's presenting it is the actuary that's on a retirement board, so hopefully he can come up with something to make it, because he had to talk to her himself to understand how did you get $1.5 million,
right.
and he got himself comfortable with it, because we were just like, I don't understand. It's such a small change. I mean, $5 a month for each retiree, and there are not a lot of retirees. It's hard to wrap your mind around how the number grows to that, but he felt comfortable after seeing her calculation.
Well,
that
I mean,
was right.
It's 15,000 the first year, but the second year it's 30,000.
Exactly, because you're
so when you
you're
bring
giving
that up
it
to 11 years, I get about 700,000 right there, and that's only on the existing retirees.
Right.
So you got the new retirees as well. So that's.
It makes sense after you
yeah.
start thinking about it. It's not just
that's
a one-time increase; they're getting it every year.
Yes.
Right, and probably just showing one either 13 or the 14, because then you just start down too many roads.
Yeah.
It's showing too.
I mean,
it's pretty linear
14,
anyway.
Right? Is that what they're asking?
They proposed
for
14,
the
14 is what
right.
they
so didn't show anything about.
And that was what was worked into our evaluation. If they don't get it, it just kind of goes towards, you know, the overall liability. It doesn't change anything. So.
So is the retirement system's return on investment the same as the PRIT fund, which for I was realizing we're using shorthand again, but that's the Pension Reserves Investment Trust Fund, is that
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
For the state. And so is it equivalent? Like what? Whatever PRIT
it should
ROI
be, yes.
is what? Okay.
Mm-hmm. And they're coming out to do their presentation at our next retirement. They always come out
okay.
and kind of talk about what went right, what went wrong, what was performing well, what wasn't performing well, and, you know, giving us an idea of where we stand and... And, you know, just a general overview so we feel informed about the investments that where our money is sitting. And they talk about a lot of the changes in staffing and the qualifications of the people that are managing your money and
mm-hmm.
giving us some comfort that we're in good hands.
Mm-hmm.
We do get the statements every month and you're looking at it, but, you know, you don't have that direct contact with the people managing this money.
Right.
So give you some background, where did they come from, what do they do, you know, that sort of thing. And then what are the returns and what were the reasons for some of these declines, and you know, make us understand what we have for investments and what went right and what went wrong. So
okay.
I feel like Peter's onto something in terms of targeting that above average person, just showing the 15, showing the 30, showing just graphically showing
yeah,
that.
Yeah, there's got to be some way
there's
we
like
we had a hard time
yeah.
and he was an actuary
there.
To get
yeah.
to that number.
Yeah.
It's hard to imagine how you do it so that people can see.
Well, even if you say we project that there will be this this number of retirees for whom this will
mm-hmm.
take effect.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm not sure.
If we can get her data of how she
yeah.
calculated, maybe we can maybe better
mm-hmm.
make a representation
mm-hmm.
of it on a slide so that somebody could, who's not an actuary, could understand
mm-hmm.
this. I mean,
and explaining that it's not a bad thing, because when you see these numbers sort of double.
Yeah.
You see this cumulative effect, it can be a little shocking.
Exactly.
Well, especially at a time when we're already feeling uncomfortable about our liabilities, both for
exactly.
you know,
pension and OPEB.
Yeah, it's really hard to imagine that it will pass.
Why
when
would
we see a $1.5 million number, I'm like, okay, well, we'll see how it goes. So.
Any other questions? Okay, thanks, Sharon.
Thanks Sharon.
Chiefs.
Hello,
hello. Oh, hey guys. All right, I'll get that. We don't want to take too much of the public safety time, trust me.
Good evening, everybody. The FY18 budget is down 0.7% for the police department, FY18. It's about 94% of it consists of personnel costs. The department has been reduced by one police officer in this budget to 41 sworn officers, two civilian employees, a civilian part-time parking enforcement officer, a civilian part-time animal control officer, 19 per diem crossing guards for schools. And you can note that we also increased the lieutenants by one. We have four lieutenants now in the police department, and we decreased the sergeants by one. So we now have seven sergeants as of this past January in the police department. One of the notes of noteworthy rises up top is the overtime this past, right now in the current FY17 budget. We've been down five officers for the past year in calendar year 2016. Three of them due to illness and injury, and two that we finally were able to hire two additional bodies to replace Chief Cormier and a detective from last year. So for the whole calendar year, I was down five officers. That's why the overtime's been up. I actually ended up moving a detective out of detective position into patrol to cover some of the costs of the normal routine patrol, everyday routine patrol.
So that overtime was up, but salaries were a bit down.
Correct, right, especially the patrol line, and also the deputy chief, because I went about 7 or 8 months without having a deputy police chief as well. If you look at the police stats, we've been up a little bit, not as much right in these current stats right here, but we averaged 20,000 calls for service a year. And one thing I did do is kind of take apart some of the quality of life issues that we deal with, drugs, mental health, elder issues. Those are calls that for service that sometimes can take up to, we've had calls that have taken 8 hours, a whole shift to deal with one person or one child or one issue, you know, and those are the things that take a lot of time. So it may not show a lot of numbers, but they take a lot of significant time of our officers to deal with on a routine basis.
20,000 a year astounded me. I had no frame of reference to this.
So in this past year, actually, we've had a lot of serious crimes. I don't recall, I had back on Easter Sunday morning, I had a hostage situation that you know, lasted several hours before we were able to make an arrest. We've had several armed robberies this past year, several bank robberies. So we've been up a little bit on the Part 1 crimes, which are the violent felony crimes as well this past year. This past year also, I boosted that support services division, so that's where the extra lieutenant went. So I have a lieutenant in charge of detectives, I have a lieutenant in charge of day shift patrol, a lieutenant in charge of night shift patrol, and I have a lieutenant now in charge of support services. The support services lieutenant is in charge of three police officers, which is the traffic and safety officer, the armor fleet maintenance officer, which is the same person, the community service officer, and one civilian who functions as the parking enforcement and animal control officer. We process all the license to carries for firearms for the town. We had 260 new applications in 2016, and we had 50 that carried over from 2015. A traffic and safety officer deals with many issues between the schools, any issues you have with the traffic and control devices out in the normal public on a daily basis. And the community service officer, I actually boosted that position this past year and added a lot more to that position, which consists of dealing with the seniors on a routine basis, handling all the solicitor applications, serves as the elder human services, protective services liaison. We gave multiple station tours. We do civilian fingerprints. We worked with Sheriff Katusian on a program to deal with the elderly and protecting themselves against identity fraud. We've done four coffee with the cops this past year. We've had two RAD classes, the rape aggression defense women's classes, where I think we had over 60 women take. Correct. We re-implemented the helmet incentive through the summer with the kids wearing bicycle helmets. Free ice cream programs. We were on the Fall Street Fair Committee, and we organized the Citizens Police Academy for the first time in about 10 years this past year as well. Let's see, and on the following page, we also had approximately 360 public records requests over in 2015 and again in 2016. They can take from 10 minutes to multiple days to figure out, depends upon what exactly they're looking for, the request is, and how much we have to actually go and investigate and find the paperwork from how many years back. So that could take from minutes to hours and days, depending upon how much research it takes. We're pretty much level funded for all the equipment issues. except that we went up a little bit on the police dues and memberships. We're a member of the NEMLIC, which is the Northeast Massachusetts Law Enforcement Council, which is 61 cities and towns, who, for example, when the SWAT team came in that morning on Easter, it was one of our offices, but also 40 people from outside of our department, which we do not have to reimburse or refund for any issues. Any unforeseen emergency circumstances that we need help with, we do have the manpower between the STARS program, which is in the schools, if there's any issues at the schools, the SWAT team, the RRT, and also the bicycle and the motorcycle. You know, if there's any issues we ever have with traffic safety, anything like that, we can call these officers in from other towns to help us out. And it's all on the other departments to help fund it. And it's also on us. We have to have 10% of our department is involved with NEMLIC, including myself. That's the police department. Before we go to any of the others, any questions? Feel free to ask.
Okay.
Sure. Yep.
It says one is a holdout. There were two budgeted, right?
Correct. We average, so we have 18 marked and unmarked vehicles total. One, we like to replace 2 a year because we average about 80 to 100,000 miles within a 2 year period on each car. It takes a beating because they're going, a lot of them are going 24/7. So we like to replace 2 a year to keep them up. You know, and the town manager asked for this year if we could hold back one to go towards the school budget, which I'm hoping to possibly get back in November, but we'll speak about that, I guess, in a few months.
Is there any concern from a safety perspective there as far as holding back?
For that one car, no. No, not for this. I mean, obviously, you know, the better equipment that I can continue to have with the officers, because they are, you know, these cars are sometimes going at faster paces than normal cars, and it would be nice to have, you know, to make sure the maintenance-wise and everything else, they can keep up. But for one car, I wouldn't. If we took two of them, I would have a big concern for this coming year. That would be, if we didn't get to replace two this coming year, I'd be asking for three LGS.
Thank you.
And the holdback amount is 42 then?
Right. 42, yes, sir.
Yep.
Other questions?
So as you were talking about, you know, overtime being up, salaries being down, but still on a net for all salaries, it's a little higher than
correct
for year to date.
Right, and one of the reasons is for all salaries, yeah, it is a little higher there. One of the reasons is, I think it's just because of the overtime is so high right now at 96. That's outrageous for how much it's cost this past year at overtime. And it's basically been because of the five officers that we've had down. We're running, without giving numbers here tonight specifically, we're running some of the same numbers that we've run in the last 20 years since I've started. I said that in front of the Board of Selectmen for minimums, you know. So we go down to a very low number, you know, of officers working against a specific shift when we're not fully staffed. And there's only so far we can go without being in the dangerous zone. You know, I mean, we're great for the first call, maybe the second. If the third call comes in during a, you know, a busy shift, we're going to be asking for mutual aid, you know. I'd like to sit here and tell you, and I have many talked to the town manager about it, but all the different new developments going into the town, I'd like to see us go increase in officers, because we're really, I really believe that over the last few years we've definitely gone up in crimes, and some of the seriousness of the crimes and what we're dealing with and how much time we spend on each call, we really should be going the opposite direction. I mean, well, the two towns around us, I can compare us to Wakefield and Wilmington, they have approximately the same amount of people, and Wakefield has three additional officers, Wilmington has seven or eight more officers than we do, you know, so just so we, you know, understand where I'm coming from.
Mm-hmm. Does this overtime number reflect the consideration
of
what will happen? Because the same level of service needs to be provided.
Correct.
So what will happen with overtime there?
So if we have this year, right now I have three officers, one going in the academy right now, and I have two actually coming in the academy in 2 weeks.
March,
yeah. So actually, that is March.
March 14th.
Yeah,
sorry.
So in 2 weeks, we have two more starting the academy. They won't get out until the end of August. Then they do field training for about 2.5 months. So for the till November, it's gonna hurt a little bit, but after that, as long as we don't have any more retirements or any more people disabled or sick, we should be in better shape. You know, the reason is the going up for the overtime was we have many people on steps in both ranks, so the step increases, which, you know, when they get it raised, then obviously their overtime rate goes up as well. That's what's causing the increase in that.
But your burn rate for overtime is not gonna change between
between now and the end of the year.
Not between now and the end of the year, no. Nope.
Because people out sick and stuff, that's still an exposure.
Correct. Right now, yeah, 100%. Yeah, we have, right now I still have five, I'm down five officers right now still currently, you know, until at least.
Likely through July.
Yeah, at least, well three through July and then two more past. Yeah, at least three till that, at least down five till then. After that point, we'll have three down, and then two more should be coming on board in August, but they really won't be out on their own until after November because of field training.
Even the person that just graduated the academy back in January is still in field training, which it's an additional training to learn Reading's ways, Reading computer system, that type of thing after the academy. And he still doesn't count as a body right now until he's off that. So we can't.
So how long is that? So after you hire someone, how long do you expect?
10 weeks.
10 to 12 weeks,
yeah,
depending on
depending
schedule.
On the schedule. Yeah, 10 to 12 weeks.
And that's after a 6 month academy.
Right. And that's normal across the whole country. That's not just Reading doing that as extra. It's
yeah.
Just that they really have to learn.
Wait, but you said after a 6 month academy.
So they've been in like, so we hire somebody, like we're hiring these two officers
yeah.
on March 14th. They'll go to a 6 month police academy. And
oh.
then when they graduate the police academy.
Oh, they are employed when they go through.
Correct.
Yes, yeah, you have to be hired before you go, and you cannot work as a police officer until you've been through the academy, get sworn in.
So you don't do that on your own and apply for a job?
Not in Massachusetts.
Not in Massachusetts.
We have to put you through. We pay you to go through.
Wow.
You pay for the academy. The way we have it set up is we pay for your uniforms. It's a $3,000 fee for the academy. You will. The town provides the money up front, and then the officer or the student recruit,
yeah.
if they go through the academy, pays the town back over the 6 month period the $3,000. But we're also giving them
a
salary.
Correct.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yep.
Yeah, to go to the academy.
Benefits and yep, and
yep.
then they go through a 10 week FTO program afterwards, after the 6 months.
FTO.
Field training officer. It's field training. It's a program designed to, and it's a nationwide program designed to teach the officers. You learn general at the academy. Now you learn very specific, because every town uses a different computer system. Every town has slightly different paperwork, different policy procedures, and that's what you learn during that field training officers program. It's refined more towards Reading during that period.
So you almost lose 9 months. You hire.
Correct, absolutely. So for example, we offered two people jobs in November. The next academy wasn't available till March. So they won't be on the road till November, so it takes almost a year to hire someone. And that's without civil service, and we have a very streamlined testing process. If we had civil service, still could have taken 6 months to get a list.
It's so funny, I just wrote that down. I was going to ask how that.
Yeah,
civil service.
It's much smoother than it could be with civil service, but it still takes up to a year to get someone into a position. That's the problem.
And it's a lot of times it's us waiting for an academy. We have one out in New Braintree right now, one just graduated Randolph, and we have two going to the Reading Academy. And it's just finding an academy slot can be out of our hands a lot of the times too.
Right, and in this line of work, you don't hire someone who is already a police officer elsewhere.
So we have tried that. It doesn't always work out. We had a couple last year. We had actually offered conditional office to, and through background investigations, we found out why they were leaving other departments, and we had to rescind our office.
So people
have
to stay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. You know.
And we have lucked out. We have had a few police officers
mm-hmm.
that have had the academy, and then that's been that has worked out, but sometimes it hasn't.
So it must just be really hard resource planning wise, even when you know someone's also going to retire. You almost have to hire them a year early to
you really,
flow
right.
right into not
it,
having any loss.
It would
resources.
Be perfect, but you really can't, because the problem
yeah,
is if they pull back the paperwork, then they're then
oh,
we're
yeah,
stuck.
You can't. It's very expensive.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah correct.
But,
you know.
Wow. Wow.
Right.
That's really hard.
Yeah, it is. Absolutely, yep. So,
why, much as it's difficult to eliminate a job in the police department, the alternative was to hire someone, to invest that year, and then in a year be eliminating the same person. It makes no sense. So when you have an opportunity with a retirement, fortunately that's the opportunity where you need to decide to eliminate the position. Otherwise you invest in the person for a year and they go work somewhere else. So it is a very difficult department to restaff as is fired.
All
right,
is that
similar?
Similar.
I'll talk about it.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was an education.
Absolutely.
Just one curiosity question on page 49, parts of crimes of fraud. This fraud is significant, but what type of fraud do you have in town that you would investigate?
A lot of it is stuff over the internet. We've had people scammed for thousands of dollars over the internet, and some of it we can we can help people with some where we can't. We've had gypsy operations scams in town. We actually had a palm reader one time that scammed $40,000 off of an elderly resident. So a lot of it's things like that. We've had
tax returns.
Yeah, tax returns, you know, things like that that people end up falling for. They're all, you know, even if they're nationwide, they fall on the local department to at least start the investigation.
Yeah. You have to report it to the local police department. Yes. Other questions? Okay, Eric.
Chief, you noted that you, because of the absences and everything, police officers, you had to move one detective?
Correct.
And I also noted in the narrative that the detective load has been increasing due to complexity. I mean,
absolutely.
Can you comment on the result of having to do that?
That's actually gone up. Some of my overtime budget's been for the detectives because, for example, like we had the high school break the other night.
Yeah.
I had a detective that happened a little after 1 o'clock, well, a little after midnight, but by the time we got a call, a little after 1 o'clock in the morning, I had to bring a detective in. So the detective was here for his own shift didn't start till 7 a.m. So from 1:15 till 7 a.m., he was on overtime, you know. When we had the bank robberies on the weekends, I've had two or three detectives in on overtime because I have our detectives in their contract. It's Monday through Friday, days or nights, but weekends and holidays, they're off. So anything that happens on a weekend or holiday or overnight, you know, our detectives work, actually the one that's retired, so right now we don't have any work until 11 p.m., but normally I'd like to have one on until 11 p.m., but anything from 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. is all, has to be called at home and brought in from home.
Still just stressing the overtime.
Yeah, absolutely, right.
We need these perpetrators to do things between 9 and 5.
Right. Yeah, right. Monday through Friday, no holidays, no weekends.
Do they get overtime?
Same question I asked Gene, actually. It's kind of higher level, but we don't spend too much time on it. But the demographic trends with the elderly population increasing, what's the impact on public safety resources, like short and longer term? I saw the one thing that jumped out was the welfare checks. So you do one every 2 to 3 days.
Right.
But what other ways would that demographic shift affect public safety resources?
Well, besides when it's elderly abuse areas like that and issues with to deal with that, more of it would be on the fire department, I would say, because we respond to all calls with the fire department for elderly, you know, responses. A lot of them are in our medicals, and that would be the only thing I would think would go up more than, you know, any elder services we deal with very well with Gene's people on a daily basis sometimes. But in general, I think elderly-wise, I would say it's more going to fall on the fire department with medicals.
Yeah, with the elderly population seeing two things, an increase for responses, three things, increase for welfare checks, because people move to different parts of the country, and a lot of our elderly people live alone. So if they haven't heard from them in a day or so, they get concerned and they ask for a 911 response to check them out. And the other type of response that we've seen going up is somebody that needs just a little bit of assistance. They can't get out of a chair. They've fallen on the floor. They're living at home, but they're not able to care for themselves all the time. So they'll get themselves into a spot where they need somebody to come and help them, or they're not going to be able to get off the floor or something. So we'll respond and help them, do an evaluation, see if they need medical care. If they do, we transport them. If not, then and they're safe to remain there, we'll let them stay where they are.
So just to be clear, in the welfare check, it's both departments.
Both departments.
Absolutely. Yeah, because that welfare check, you don't know if it's because they're down on the floor with a medical condition. It's somebody saying, I haven't seen this person for a couple of days, and, you know, and there's something going on. They should be at an appointment, or they should be here. So, and what it can involve is a forcible entry into the home, because we can't just go there and bang on the door and then go away. We need to force entry and then search the home.
So great. Is that actually three vehicles responding?
Yeah, it would be a fire truck, it would be an ambulance, it would be a police officer.
Right, so the three vehicles responding.
Yeah. And then it's a forcible entry, it's a search of the home, and it's not uncommon to find somebody on the floor that's been on the floor for a period of time that needs to be transported. So.
Another thing I just want to add is with the police department is I've really tried this past year, we've tried, to build our community relationships up with all of our different activities and really the commitment with the community. And that's one thing, budget-wise, I really have talked to the town manager, but I don't want to lose, is that I really have tried to be out there as much as the community, even between social media, my own social media, department social media, all the different events we get going on. And that's something I don't think we had, we kind of lost a little bit of, and I don't want to go backwards. So that's one thing, budget-wise, no, I'm trying to make it work the best I can, because I think if having that partnership with the community, when things don't go right, or when people, you know, understand what's going on, they can come and they know we're a friendly face, we are who we are, you know, gladly come out to any meetings, Mark knows, anything you need to deal with, you know. So absolutely, but it's more, you know, it's really not just like one person, it's the whole department. I really am trying to involve as many officers as possible to buy into the actual doing the community policing part, because it means something, you know. I mean, I live in town, I'm around everywhere, you know, and it's like, it's just, I have a kid at Coolidge and a kid at the high school. So, you know, and it's good because we're part, and so is Dave, we're part of the community. We're not just coming here for work, we're here every day here, you know. So,
a couple more questions there. Just
sure.
A quick comment though, on the liaison at public safety, so I came to talk to you a couple months ago, and you suggested you should do Citizens Police Academy. I'll say that I would love to, but I'm on FinCom and Mark runs a tight ship, and I just don't want to.
Well, definitely.
So we do have Citizens Police Academy?
So yes, we hadn't had one in about 9 or 10 years, but we ran one this past fall. We had, what, 28 people run through it? And I want to do this coming fall, at least one. I'd like to do 2 a year. Right now, it's not quite feasible, but at least one a year in the fall. It worked out really well last year. The officers love it because they get to actually show off their whatever their specialty is. A lot of the biggest thing I've heard from coming people that go is they didn't really know what we do on a daily basis, or you know what the detectives do, what patrols do. And you get to do, if you finish the police academy, you get to do a ride along, at least one, possibly two if you want. So if, you know, some night if you want, come in with us, and we'll, after you're all done, you can come through a ride and see what we actually really do out there.
Yeah, I'd never heard of that. My parents did it in their town. I'd never heard of it, so I thought that was the only time I did it, because I thought that's great PR.
Absolutely.
Oh, absolutely. I have two rad grads in my family, too.
Oh, that's right. I'm a rad grad, man.
There you go.
They're both my daughters. They weren't allowed to go to school.
That's right.
We should have 32 books for this. We have a waiting list now, so we should have 32 books for the next rad class coming up.
I've always told people, do not send a girl away to college without taking rad.
Is there any police department involved with any kind of restorative justice programs or any
With the Middlesex County. Well, actually, we actually initiated a diversion program about 5 or 6 years ago on our own, the Reading Police Diversion Program, which we've actually had calls from the district attorney's office to go and actually do showings of it with other departments, because they actually thought it worked so well. And it really, ACASA does an outstanding job. Julia, who works for ACASA, really runs the program for us with our prosecutor. And it's for youths. With that one, is a lot of youths are under 21 that have had substance abuse issues. And if they've been involved with the first time offense, they go through a program with ACASA. We give them community service. They go up. We hold over their head for a certain amount of time, though, exactly what we need them to do, and if they don't do it, then those charges can be brought forward. Mm-hmm. But if they do what we tell them, they'll have a clean slate, you know. So, and we really monitor, and Julie does an excellent job of monitoring them. It's a weekly monitoring with these kids, or young adults, I should say, you know. So, and it seems to work really well. In the other one, the Middlesex County one, we've had a few kids involved with a little bit more serious offenses, but nothing life shattering that shouldn't ruin that life forever.
Yeah.
You know, vandalism that they. A stupid night that they got involved in something dumb, and you know what, something that really shouldn't ruin their whole lives. But again, we go through the Middlesex County working with the district attorney's office, and can get them to a diversion program that, listen, if you do what they tell you to do, and you go by the rules, and you pay back, and you may even have to go, for example, we had one had to go in front of a board in town that was a private board, that they had done some damage to this actual club, and they had to go in front of and talk about it with the actual members, which is a very difficult thing for a 19-year-old kid to do. But they had to do it, and you know what? That was a couple years ago. They've been very successful, you know. And then it doesn't give them a record, because then colleges won't, you know, sometimes accept them, or loans or grants or whatever. So we try, you know, because we're all been there. You know, we've all been kids one time or another. Mm-hmm. Or we have kids, you know. Mm-hmm. So I just want to point out, we are an accredited department. I'm sure everybody does know that for the last. We just got reaccredited back in August. There's over 200 standards and policies that we actually have to best practices. We've been accredited by the Mass Police Accreditation Commission, and it's every 3 years. And basically, we have over 200, like I said, standards and policies, the best practices in Massachusetts. And what it does for us is it basically allows us, grant-wise, to get more additional grants, and also it allows us to get better rates for our insurance through Maya, because it, and lawsuit-wise, God forbid, it could hold us off, because we are doing what exactly we say we're going to do with the best practices. And it's a lot of work, but it's something I really do keep at the forefront to say it's something we have to continue to do. We can't allow that to go backwards and be unaccredited. There's only about 51 towns in Massachusetts right now that are accredited, and we're one of them.
Oh, wow.
So.
Do you have more?
Just a couple more quick questions on how things are trending, Chief. The gun license applications, 216 in the past year, is that increasing?
That honestly has gone up a small amount, but it's going up every year. You know, it's going up about 10% a year.
Just more time you have to spend. And then public records request was noted in the narrative,
yeah,
that you expected that to increase. Why?
With the new public records law, now people can get them. Used to have to fill out a form and come in. Now people can get them electronically. And it's, they made it a little easier this past January 1st for the state. So the problem, it's good, fine for the public. The problem with us is it takes more additional time, you know. And everything now electronic that we have, people are going to want copies of, or they can, you know, request copies of. And absolutely, we have nothing to hide, but the thing is it just takes someone to go through, because a lot of it has to be redacted, because if it's an ongoing investigation, or it involves a juvenile, or it involves a domestic, or it involves several other types of crimes, we can't just give you the information while redacting everything. So that takes someone a lot of time to go through, whether it's an audio, a visual, or a written document.
Just a comment, I guess what I'm seeing at a high level is just a lot of stresses, right? So the open positions, the time it takes to fill somebody, the more time spent on public records requests, gun licenses, the increasing complexity with the detectives and the welfare checks and all that. From a financial perspective, which is what we talk about, it's going to pop out in overtime, I guess. But I'm sure there are other costs, certainly, than that, around just your team.
My phone rings 24/7 to cost at home, but that's another story. Anyways. But seriously, yeah, it is. It comes up, and it's unpredictability. That's the problem with the cost, is that sometimes we're riding school, but we had an officer hurt on an arrest a couple days ago. Now he's going to be out for 2 weeks. So there's just another small, you know, hopefully he'll be back within 2 weeks, you know, recover fully. But again, it costs, because now he's home, we have to cover his shift. You know, so with even the small one, it's unpredictable. You don't know what's going to happen on a daily basis.
All set? Roll on.
Got our CASA. Our CASA is grant funded completely through September of 2019. It's, you can see the numbers down the bottom. The only main difference we did this past year, we experimented in the end of 2016. We've had a lot of calls with opiate problems. So we took out, over a period of time in 2016, it was the end of November through the end of December, and we had about 13 calls for service that was specifically opiate related. We went back to look in 2015 over the same amount of time, and we only had two. So again, that could just be a blip, but that we'll see how it goes this current year and see exactly where we're at. I can tell you we've had, you know, significant amount of overdoses and issues with opioids over the last couple of years. But they do an outstanding job. Besides everything they do with the helping us with all the things they do in the schools, they're very much a help, like I said, at the level of the helping us with the deterrences and the keeping the kids the programs we run with the children at the high school as well. So,
Chief, their grant will cover 18 and 19, and then it ends.
Covers 18 and part of 19. I think it's going to end in September 29th of 19. September 30th of 19. No, because this was the second time it was renewed. There is, according to Erica, there's no more. That's all. The federal government gives you it twice, so it's up to 10. It'll be 10 years when it went out. In the middle, we did have 1 year. I think there was an overlap or so back years ago that the town did cover our CASA for. But Erica was fortunate enough to get the grant a second time for 5 more years.
So in September of 2019, the town had a decision, we have a decision to make.
Correct.
Yeah. Plus, I'm sure that she'll be looking for other grants, but
absolutely
maybe not.
Yeah. But they won't be. I don't think
they'll
be exactly.
Yeah.
You know,
just funded through FY19.
half or partway through.
Partway through.
3 months.
July, August, September.
September.
19.
All good?
Okay. And then the only one I get for me, if you don't mind skipping a couple pages, just right to the dispatch. Let's go through that real quick, fast. There's a 1.8% increase in dispatch over FY17, 95% of it is personnel. We have currently one head dispatcher and 10 civilian telecommunicators. Pretty much, besides the payroll increases, everything else is level funded for the year. They do a heck of a lot of work, these dispatchers. They're 24/7. We end up, besides dispatch and medicals, they answer the phone calls for all the police department, a lot of the fire department. They give out a lot of the compost depot stickers, 24 hours a day. They handle any complaint that comes into the station, looking to speak to anyone. They have to do the initial contact at the police station. I think we get a lot of bang for our buck with these people. They're outstanding. They really are under a lot of stress. They're in a fishbowl a lot because they're the initial people that people want to blame when they call. They're the people that people get frustrated with. They're the ones when, God forbid, someone's dying or something else, that have to answer the phone. They deal with a car accident. They deal with everything 24/7, you know, and there's a small amount of them that really, and they're in a tight little quarters, a lot of hours together to get a real big job done for this town and community.
One question, Chief, on mutual aid. How do you evaluate, are we getting our fair share, giving our fair share? Are we in about the right spot?
For when we need help?
Yeah.
So it's with the police department, we try to do everything on our own. It would take a significant call or a significant accident or something major before we'd actually ask for mutual aid. Unlike the fire department, it's not quite as well run. They have more standards for mutual aid. Ours, we actually would literally call North Reading Police and ask for two cruisers or a cruiser to help us out. Same thing with Storm. We go on the attack channel, ask for them to help if we're in the southern part of town. And they come right up. Glad they come up. We have a mutual aid memorandum of understanding through the NEMLA communities, which we can go to any of the towns and work without a problem. So that's no issue at all. But it's not as easily done as the fire department has a planned event that the police departments do. So, but again, there's usually no issue coming. It's just that on a busy Saturday night, there's a lot going on in different towns. It could be correct.
And so how does that work? So you get called, that, let's say, 55 car pileup in Wakefield.
Yep.
Did you get calls for
actually
that?
It's funny, I don't think the police department, we didn't respond to that at all because
that's shocking.
Yeah, I was actually surprised the fire department did, though.
Fire department.
Yeah. But we had for example, years ago when the officer got shot in front of Kohl's, almost our whole department was over there that December 26th, because we were like, I think we actually beat the officers.
We beat the Woburn officers there.
Wow.
So North Reading came down to cover us because we couldn't leave Reading open. So North Reading sent one cruiser, Estonium sent one cruiser to cover Reading for us while we were all in Woburn.
So you got a phone call. It goes.
Or on the radio, yep.
Okay.
Yep. It could be on the radio. It could be one of their OICs, the officer in charge, calling our dispatch, asking for help. We respond immediately. So.
But right, I could see that being more in a fire, you know, because you tend to have the intense, concentrated issues versus.
We went to that incident, since Chief Jackson went to that shooting incident with the Woburn police officer as well, but for the standard fire mutual aid, it's a radio call, and we go. We're monitoring what the alarm levels are, and at a specific level, we go. Ambulance mutual aid requests through the radio most of the times, and we respond mutual aid and receive mutual aid on a daily basis, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very good value for the town. It really works well.
There's a minimum staffing you have to maintain in order to get mutual aid, right?
The way the mutual aid is that you're supposed to staff your community to handle your routine things. Mutual aid is for the non-routine things.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So Stoneham has a fire, that's a non-routine thing. We'll go down and help them out. But once it gets beyond a certain level, they need to, another community needs to look at what their staffing is. So they can't basically
shift
it. It's
not regulated from the state?
Not at all, no.
Okay.
No. It's through agreements through individual communities, and it's through agreements through fire districts that we're part of. And we're part of what's called Metro Fire, and they have an agreement where each community has 1/3 of their fire apparatus available for mutual aid. So, you know, Reading wouldn't send all their equipment out of town, so would save 2/3 of it back for us, would send an engine company down to assist anybody within that district. And then there's a statewide fire mobilization plan for when things get really large to go, when Metro Fire is exhausted, they go beyond that level.
Any more questions for police?
One quick one on dispatch.
Sure.
You note again, complex, becoming more complex due to changes in technology and other requirements. Is there going to become a point, and you have line of sight into when that is, where there'll be some mandated change that needs to happen with our technology, with our equipment?
I wouldn't say mandated, but it's coming up. I think we have it in the fiscal plan for several years already now, for about a $500,000 redo of all of dispatch. Because when they first put our dispatch at our station now, a lot of it was piecemeal back then even, and we've done a pretty good job of trying to keep it up between us and the fire department. But as things and technology grows, it's really going to be time eventually we take the hit, and we're going to end up having to do the whole dispatch center over. You know, most departments around. We'll look for grants. We'll look for anything we can. We just haven't seen much out there. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Thank you.
Pass it up to Greg.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. You'll be here if I need you.
Yeah, I'm ready.
Mutual aid.
That's right, mutual aid. The fire department budget, just a little bit about the fire department. We have four major functions, fire suppression, fire prevention, the emergency medical system, and emergency management. So for the FY18 budget, we're reducing our staffing by one firefighter. Our budget increase request is 2.3% over FY17, and our salary budget is 96% of the budget. We have 48 full-time employees. We're primarily organized around four groups. There's a captain, lieutenant, and then 9 firefighters per group. And we also have an assistant chief and a fire prevention officer. This year, we did a similar restructuring as the police department did. We reduced our lieutenants by one and increased our captains by one. So our fire prevention position is now a captain, and we did that to give us more flexibility. For example, I had an officer that was out for a knee surgery, and I reassigned him to a group to cover that spot. So I saved from having to hire on an overtime basis to fill that spot, and I put a very qualified person into that spot. So the group was running properly, and it also saved us some overtime money. So it was a cost-effective way to give us some flexibility. In calendar year 2016, we responded to just over 3,400 emergency calls for assistance. Of that, just over 2,000 involved some level of emergency medical response. And when you look at our stats, approximately 40 of the incidents were classified as structure fires according to the state fire marshal's requirements, 10 fires in mobile equipment, and 34 outside fires. Some of the highlights of the salary budget, if you take a look at that. Well, before I get to that, I'll just stay along with this format so I don't get people lost. What we're seeing is an increase in ambulance transports, an increase in medical calls, and that's also led to an increase in ambulance revenue, in part because we increased our fees a little over a year ago, and also in part because we were transporting additional people. You know, as our population goes up, you know, we're in as the population ages, we see more requests for service. little bit about emergency management. Where we identify areas of vulnerability for the community, we're prepare for disasters, whether natural or man-made, and we coordinate the response of a wide range of agencies to assist in the recovery phase. The secondary goal is to make sure that we're in compliance with any state or federal requirements, so we're eligible to get reimbursed for a federal disaster declaration. And where we've seen those in this community in my tenure is from storm-related incidents. It may be flooding or major snowstorms. The last one we did was 2 years ago, and it's a considerable amount of work to do the filing for it, not just for me, but also for the DPW. Mike O'Halloran at the DPW does a tremendous amount of work compiling all the costs, contractors' costs, when the people worked, how much sand was used, how much salt was used. Also the police department, what their costs were. And each one is different on how they how they write it, determines what's eligible. So for the 2015, you have to go to a kickoff meeting. They tell you what's eligible, and then you do some preliminary costs. You meet with them, and then you put your application together. They go away for a couple of months. You file your application, and then it gets reviewed. And then they have a series of questions. You answer those questions. And then generally they tell you what the amount is going to be approved, and then you get that check. This year was different. It went through another review. Everybody's went through another review. So for the
it costs a lot of money to get money.
It's very involved. This year we just signed our contracts about 3 or 4 weeks ago for the blizzard of 2015. So the amount was less than what we had been approved for earlier. So we're going through a review process to kick that level up. So it's a very involved process to get that money for the community, but you know, our job of all of us that applies, police, DPW, fire, facilities, is to make sure that we're aware of what's eligible to be reimbursed and document that, and then make sure the community gets that back, because it can be over $100,000 for the community. So it's a lot of work to get that back. But If you haven't done the proper training that they require, incident command training and other things, not just fire, but police department, DPW, town manager, then you're not eligible for it. So you have to identify what you need to do, make sure that that's in place, and then go through the filing. So it's an involved process, but it's financially it's worth it, and then when the case of a disaster strikes, it's worth it to have, you know, a group that of all the departments that can come together as a group and then formulate a response to the type of to whatever incident it is. So since 2001, we've received over $1.2 million. So after this reimbursement, it will be at least around $100,000 that we'll receive. Hopefully it'll be more than that. So that'll kick it up to over $1.3 million back to the community. So it's a lot of money for the community. So on our expense budget, our expenses are going up 7.1%. And this is due primarily to one-time things for this fiscal year only. We had some needs that the town manager addressed for us. One of the needs is for radio batteries for all our portable radios for emergency communications. They're expensive because they have to be rated to be what's called intrinsically safe, so that, you know, in an atmosphere that's flammable, that they won't cause a spark that would be a source of ignition. The fire equipment maintenance and service repair account was increased $8,000 to purchase equipment that would be used to protect firefighters that are operating on the scene of a violent person, and we need to provide them with a certain level of protection so they can render medical aid under really difficult conditions. The fire apparatus maintenance and service repair account increased $2,000 for some repair and replacement of valves and nozzles. firefighter training was increased 1,000, and that's used for paramedic and EMT licenses for renewals and for tuition costs for outside training. And then the ALS medical supplies account was increased 5,000. We're seeing increased costs in medications and disposable supplies. But some of the medication costs have just gone up really significantly. One of them, just to give you an example, epinephrine for an allergic reaction for the auto injectors, it's over $300. It's just insane. But we have to carry a certain number of those on the ambulance. And so we registered our engines. So we have two engines and a ladder truck, the fire apparatus. We registered those as class 5 ambulances. That allows us to put medications on those. So when the ambulance is out, we have a medical call. We have paramedics and EMTs arrived. We make sure that we give them the equipment that they have, but it has to be licensed. And so we can carry the medications that we need. So we have to have epinephrine on that. So it gives us an increased cost, but the level of service to the community is far outweighed by what the cost is. But it's just a huge amount of money for that type of medication. But that's kind of what we're dealing with on some of these medications. And that's kind of the highlights on the salary side of the budget. I have two captains that are going through the step system because they were recently promoted, and I have 4 lieutenants that are going through the step system because they were recently promoted, and we also have 6 firefighters that are moving through the step program because we're at a
so
department.
What do you mean by moving through the step?
By contract, as they each year, because when they start off, they start off at an entry level and they go up. A little bit same with the police department. Our overtime has been hit hard this year. We've had we had 2 new firefighters that we brought on that started in August. Same as the police department, we hire them. We identify who we hire. We get an academy date for them, and then we hire them based upon that date. So we bring them in just a week before they go to the academy, and then we send them off to the academy. But we're paying their salary when they're at the academy. They're there for 10 weeks, and then they come back to us. And then we do an in-house training program for a couple of weeks, and then they're counted as part of our shift strength. So these firefighters started for us in August, and they didn't complete the training program until Thanksgiving weekend. So that's when they were counted. So all that time period, we paid their salary, but we were still really on our rosters down to 2 people. And then we had some injuries, so that brought us down further. At the end of December, we had a captain retire, and we're not filling. We made our promotions, but we're not filling the firefighter's position for that. So we lost a position there. This April, we're going to have another retirement, a planned retirement, and we're going to be filling that position. We've just started that process now. I'll have to identify when I can get them into the academy, and that's when we'll start that person. But when we go through the process to hire a person, it takes us several months to go through it. We go through our interview process, a background check, we identify who we want, and then the offer letter goes out, and then they have to take a physical abilities test through civil service. So that has to be scheduled. It's offered, you know, like once a month or so. And then first they need a medical evaluation, then they take the physical abilities test. Then they're eligible. Then when I have that material, then I can take that to the fire academy and then put the name into the queue for an academy class. So in all likelihood, it'll be around the summertime when I can get them in. So we'll be short through the summertime this position as they're going through the training process. So it's a little bit of an involved process to get them up and trained. And is that a question?
Go ahead, Paul.
Sorry, general question. So you talk about being down, you know, having one less firefighter.
Yes.
And I know we've talked a lot in the past in the context of overtime, the coverage plan and how you cover each of the shifts and how you have to have a certain number of people for those shifts so people get called in on overtime based on that. So how does your staffing plan change with one less firefighter? How do you not end up paying for that in overtime? It's really what I'm trying to
do. We increased the overtime, the town manager increased the overtime budget $30,000 because we recognize that this is going to cost us overtime. Losing that position will cost us overtime. What we were set up for was one group had 12 firefighters assigned to it. Three of them had 11. So if I had a group that somebody was out injured, I would transfer somebody to cover that spot. So then I would have four groups at 11.
And when you transfer
not,
the way you just said, you're not paying overtime?
Only to get them to that shift.
Yeah.
And then once I get them to that shift, because I can't work them too much within the...
Right, it has to be managed.
Right, yeah, I have to pick dates and manage.
Yeah.
Once I get them to that shift, then the overtime stops. And that'll plug a hole. I won't have that ability. So it's when I have somebody, when we're staffed at four groups at 11, if somebody is out, that'll drop them to 10. Anytime somebody's on vacation, that'll create a hiring situation. So...
It gives you less flexibility.
Correct. So it will, without a doubt, it will increase some overtime. I can't tell you what it is because I don't know what who would be injured and when that would happen or
hopefully
vacation
no
periods.
Uh-huh.
I, so,
just
yes.
On that point, though. Sorry.
Yeah. Go ahead.
If I'm doing my math right, it looks there's a $30,000 increase in overtime from FY17.
And that's specifically because of the reduction of one firefighter's position.
And it looks like, so overtime as a percentage of total salaries budget looks like 7-8%.
Right.
Which looks like it's up from FY17, but if I look back at 14, 15, 16, it looks like the overtime as a percentage of total is about 12%, maybe, up in the 500,000.
We've had, over the last several years, we've had a high use of overtime because of injuries, and also, we're department kind of going through, we've had people retire, and we've brought on a lot of new people, and so that training process also causes overtime, but the most of the overtime has been driven by injuries, and the need to keep the shift staff properly.
Actually, over the last several years, we've had discussions at FinCom, and I'm sure at other meetings too, about staffing and overtime. And in a sense, you were there a little bit better, and now you're going to have to pull back from it.
Right.
Ideally
for us would be a staffing at four groups at 12 with four additional firefighters. That would reduce the pressure significantly on the overtime. We wouldn't see as high a run rate on the overtime as what we've seen in the last few years, and you know there are grants out there that we could get that would help offset that cost for a couple of years, but it would require the community to say we're not going to lay off any firefighters or reduce the size of the fire department for that entire grant period. So with the position that the town is in right now, they just couldn't do that. So, and it's a competitive grant, so it's not like you just fill the paperwork off and they send you money. It's a competitive process too. So it's not a slam dunk.
Okay. Of the 48 employees, how many are ALS certified now?
I want to say 23. Yeah.
So a tremendous number.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think one of the things that maybe our community doesn't appreciate is how valuable a service we're able to provide. On response, you have people who know how to take care of you.
Absolutely, not only on the ambulance, but on the fire trucks
right.
as well, and with that equipment. And then the other thing is that we're bringing in revenue. Like last year, it was $830,000 in revenue. So that goes to offset what the cost of the fire department is, because some of our surrounding communities aren't offering that level of service, and they're not bringing in that level of revenue. So So it's a, to me, it's a very good value for the community that that when they call 911, they can get paramedic level care within minutes, and it's not dependent upon having our ambulance there.
How do you see that revenue? I should know. It's going to the general fund. So it's just part of regular revenue.
But under what category?
Sharon down there somewhere.
I'm sorry. Was the
ambulance revenue, where does that come in?
It goes to their general fund.
What's the line?
It's underestimated.
Okay. It's pretty big chunk of
the services.
Yeah.
Okay. About
7 or 8 million thousand.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are there other areas where we can provide equipment that would improve the safety and decrease the risk of injury? I know last year we had talked about the gurney that lifts so that the firemen don't have to lift the gurney, people into the ambulances. Are there more things like that we can do?
Yeah, we've done it with our new ambulance. We'll receive that stretcher that lifts automatically, because we are seeing patients get heavier, and they have to carry them down the stairs. We also bought a what's called a stair chair that does assist them going down, that they don't have to carry the full weight. The chair has these treads on it that will help them with it. They can't use it in all circumstances, but it is kind of a tool. One of the things that we're seeing kind of as the fire service industry, I was at a professional development conference today, is the longer term injuries, cancer, and cancer prevention. And through, you know, the products that are burning in the homes has changed in the last 30 years. And from the starting around the 1980s forward, we saw a lot more materials with plastics, foam rubbers, foam, polyester foams, and other synthetic materials, and they're releasing just a host of chemicals when they burn. Prior to that, most of the furniture was cotton and cotton padding, and not these very fast burning, almost like frozen chemicals is what it is. And as a result of it, we've seen a lot of high rates of cancer. So what departments are doing is they're looking at reducing the firefighters' exposure to that through cleaning of turnout gear, cleaning of themselves on scene, and handling the soiled hoses and things as kind of contaminated equipment to reduce that exposure. So that's something we're kind of seeing as an industry for long term. Boston Fire is really kind of leading the effort in this area, and they've had quite a few deaths due to cancer. In their headquarters building, they have a large meeting room, and it's all firefighters. Pictures of firefighters who have died of cancer very recently, so it's significant. So, you know, as part of the other injuries that we're seeing, you know, we've seen some knee injuries, some hip injuries, and some other things like that. And some there's not a lot of correlation from one injury to the other, so it's kind of hard to kind of say, okay, what
program can you put?
Yeah, it's not like if we're seeing like a lot of back injuries, you can bring in training for backs and things, but we're not seeing those types of things. That answer your question is kind of a long way around, but
it does. I mean, it seems if there were some kind of trend, it seems fiscally prudent and morally responsible to provide those kinds of resources.
Absolutely. When you see an injured firefighter, it obviously it impacts the budget, but it also impacts their family life and everything. It's not just, you know, a financial. So if there was a way that we could see to reduce that, we'd certainly be looking at it. We've had a lot of discussion about it, and we just haven't been able to come up with anything that you know. We've looked at our training. You know, we've done things on our training, trying to reduce the injuries on training, but on emergency scenes in people's homes and things, there's so many different variables. It's just really hard. I mean, sometimes you're in a place where they have so much stuff, it's just not a lot of room to operate. It might be in a very small bathroom, and you need to get a person that's really heavy that just can't help you and get them out. So that's a lot of times where you run into a back injury. But with, you know, lifting a heavy elderly person, we had somebody injured that needed a point where they needed a surgery. And there's no way around, that.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I guess and this is probably where you were going a little bit too on the overtime budget. I just feel like it's still not realistic. So I feel like it's just setting ourselves up for needing, you know, putting you through that pain of coming for us again. Because I agree. I think that having down off, a firefighter, that's $30,000, and we're already, almost burned through the overtime, and I'm not hearing why next year would be any different. So I just feel like it's an unrealistic amount.
If I could just make a comment.
Yeah.
It's not easy to do with the data in front of you, but if you actually took it and put it in a spreadsheet, some of the overtime, as the chief mentioned, is caused by vacant positions. So there were actually lower usage of the salary lines in some of those years, to the tune of more than $100,000. So the overtime is at $500,000 and the budget's at $350,000, it doesn't necessarily mean there's a $150,000 problem. You have to look at the whole picture. If positions were not staffed, or there was someone out on a disability retirement that hadn't yet been approved, and I don't know if you'll recall, but a few years ago we transferred that to the budget part of the benefit, so it's really not a department expense. There's reasons why overtime are high. They're not just, there's full staffing and then there's overtime on top of that. So it's a complex issue.
Yeah, but if you look historically, I still don't see how next year's amount is.
Well, I'll give you
realistic.
A preview of annual town meeting that the chiefs and deputies and I have talked. We're going to be asking for a transfer into public safety wages. There's a couple components. There's 5 retirements between the two departments, so the sick leave, vacation, buyback. I just don't remember the exact dollar figure. There's a couple smaller amounts. There's an animal control officer that we budgeted as a regionalized service. We ended up not doing that, so we have a $19,000 wage saved on the expenses. The long and short of it is, I'm asking for $40,000 for firefighter injury wages / overtime. That's not too bad. You have to understand the $40,000 right now projects out to a $75,000 or $65,000 surplus if everything happens for the rest of the year the way it's happened today. So one of the tricky parts about their budgets is they can't just go down to nothing at the end of the year. There has to be a surplus because you don't know what's going to happen in June.
Right.
Now, we've discussed whether we just change that policy and rely on FinCom's reserve fund in June, but that would pretty much mean you need to have $100,000 or more in June, and we can't know that. Even if you replenish it in April, I don't know what else is going to happen across the rest of the town. So the chief has, maybe 3 out of the last 4 years, asked for extra wage money. I should get the numbers. I don't have them. Sharon will know. A good portion of that is turned back at the end of the year and not used, but it's needed just in case. So I remember one year you asked for something like $150,000 and turned back about $100,000, for instance. So you really have to look at these numbers. I know the optics of just the overtime line looks that way, but there are other moving parts. You got to look at the total wage budget. That's the fairest thing.
Right. So looking at the overtime budget as a percentage of...
But again, if there's no one there to fill the role, you need to do it with overtime, you're saving money in the wage line. So yes, overtime might be running at 12%. But if it were fully staffed, maybe it's only running at 9%, because you've saved some kind of money in the wage line when the positions are vacant. It's not a simply math exercise.
No, I know exactly, because you totally have to look at the bottom, because what you're not going to pay here, you're going to pay there, vice versa. But
and obviously
just
wages
still seems
and overtime
are
more expensive, they're 50% more expensive.
Right, but it seems like if you're running leaner in salaries, your exposure to overtime,
absolutely.
Which was $30,000 was put in for that reason.
Yeah, so the chief
looks
saved,
like the base that we're growing on hasn't been adequate anyway.
But again, for this reason I'm explaining to you, the base by itself, if the department was fully staffed, I think both chiefs would agree that if the department was fully staffed and no injuries, the overtime is way plenty.
Mm-hmm.
But they both know that's not ever going to happen.
Exactly.
I mean,
it's never
going
to happen. I mean, we just...
It's just a question of how
we'll
many
see how
injuries
the year goes,
and how much.
Yeah.
And the variability is pretty high. I mean, the lowest I remember is maybe on average two people being out between you, and the high is maybe 5 to 8. So, you know, this is one of those snow and ice questions, if you don't mind. We could budget higher overtime and lay people off to do it. What happens in the year where we don't need that? We can also just plan to go to April town meeting for 50 grand every year because we need that cushion at the end. What do you do? You know, it's a tough call. To eliminate one of these positions is hard for a lot of reasons. But you can see one of them is they're not getting the full financial benefit of the elimination. We eliminated $150,000 of salaries. We put back about $70,000 or $60,000 or whatever it is in overtime. There's a reason for that. You have to. But what else does the organization do when it needs to eliminate? I don't know. I will say that if we had to eliminate another firefighter position, I couldn't possibly look at you in the face and just put back the small amount of overtime that I did, because the next one at the margin is much more expensive in overtime.
Really diminishing returns.
Yeah. So the next one and the one after would be hugely expensive. But this one, you can argue either way. If things work out fine, maybe we even put a little too much for that one position. As the chiefs haven't really said, they're each understaffed by, you pick a number, 4 each at a minimum. How realistic is it for Reading to discuss that we need another $1 million in salaries for public safety before even thinking about the fact that that's then accomplishing more work? It's just putting them at the staffing levels that data would suggest they should be.
Right.
It's not the community we live in right now.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, they all do the best they can. Last summer, I was rightly criticized for not letting the chiefs speak, which is partly true. There is still free speech to some degree. But you also don't want to cause undue panic. It's not like eliminating one police officer and one firefighter is going to lead to a crisis in the town. Other things may, but that fact alone won't. We're on a bad trend. We're at not a good staffing level. Rightly, there are caution flags all over the public safety department in Reading, but the results are still very good. These guys and their staffs are very proactive. They're very good planners. Most of our departments are. What we see is much more danger than what is here, but that's a concern. So,
agreed.
You can't minimize it. You have to be fair at some point. You have to say, look, we've been as creative as we can. This is now raising the risk profile of the community. There's just no way around that. That doesn't mean the risk is going to happen.
Other questions?
This means they need to stop doing your job so well.
No.
Thank you guys very much.
Thank you very much.
Very much appreciate your coming out.
Thank you.
Go through page 21 in your budgets, something called shared costs. I'm going to save most of my remarks for the actual sections, but broadly, this isn't a bad section this year. It's less than a 4% increase. When I say not so bad, that's better than, you know, 6 to 8%, which has been more traditional. 4% is terrible when your revenues are 3%. So it's still, you know, an issue. To sort of follow up on the retirement system comments, you can see that the budget in retirement is just going up 2%. In the current year, you can see it's at 97% run rate. There was an adjustment made so that the current year's budget has a $100,000 surplus. And then if you took that 100 away, next year's budget is up 4.5%.
So at April town meeting, you will see we have $100,000 to spend for other reasons, and we'll transfer out. So that 1.59% is really 4.5%. When
Sorry, can you rewind?
The budget for FY17 is too high.
Okay.
By $100,000. Yep.
Okay.
You know, when an actuary from out of town says it's very affordable, that's, you know, you've identified some of the issues, but the underlying issue is our retirement assessment in order to fund it by FY29 is 4.5% a year. Our revenues are 3%. This is another cause of our structural deficit. Once the retirement is fully funded in FY28 or 29, then we'll have OPEB. This is not a problem that's going to go away. There's going to be an ongoing pressure on the 3% revenues from this area for a very long time. There's just no getting around that.
And you're saying the 1.99 is deceiving.
It is a bit, because you really should take 100,000 away from 17.
Yeah,
although the 17 number really didn't go up 4.5% for actuarial reasons. So it isn't just moving numbers around there. At some point in that line of 4.5% increases, there wasn't one. I guess it's in the current year. Medicare is just sort of related to salaries. It's not that interesting. There was a group of long-serving employees, otherwise known as old, that weren't covered by this. So it's, if you look at the math, statistically some of the increases are higher than wage levels because we're having workers that retired that weren't covered are just replaced by those that are. So workers long ago did not get it, were not always eligible for Medicare. On page 22, there's the driving force of benefits, usually is health insurance. We did get good news from Maya a few weeks back. It allowed us to reduce our 7.5% estimate. You remember we used to 5%, so that's great. The somewhat somber side of that is it just made up for the poor state aid number we got, almost to the dollar. It was a middling like $5,000. So the $1.1 million use of free cash had jumped to 1.3 something, and now it's back to 1.1, just to give you that picture. I've met with the superintendent and three reps of the PEC, which is the collaboration of all town, school, and light department unions, to talk about, you know, are there levers to push to change the cost of health insurance. The answer until last fall was no for about 3 years. Interestingly, when you think of all the volatility, shall we say, in Washington and on this issue, the answer now has become maybe, which is really fascinating to me. I don't know how, but the insurance companies have sort of figured out there's a couple things we can offer you. And so, you know, we're going to study those. We are studying those. We've modeled some things, and I have to negotiate it with the unions. This will be, I'll say, the worst-case number for the budget if there is savings to be made. I think it won't so much be in the first year as maybe in the out years, but it's in all of our interests. We're a 71-29% split partner to reduce the cost of health insurance premiums. Both employees and the town make out if we can do that. However, if we're reducing it by cost shifting, for instance, deductibles, even as the employer, I recognize it's not fair to just do that without having some accommodation for the employee. So we've talked in the past about, you know, different strategies to accomplish that. Plus, I'll remind you, we are paying people not to take health insurance, which, as you know, I don't like, but we've saved a lot of money. We saved over $225,000 this year by doing that. And that's after paying the employees their share, which is about 25%. So health insurance, you know, is still a fundamental driver of the, you know, so-called funding gap. Being greatly relieved that it's only 5% is still very sad when your revenues are 3. And it's almost like the 5 is a once in a 5-year thing, and now they're going up again. That's what history would tell you. So, you know, we'll enjoy this while it lasts. Professionals, you know, who are very smart mathematically, simply say 10 to 15% health insurance is not sustainable. We will not have a country. So they can't answer it with math. They can only answer it with words and just say it's impossible. You can't. But the math suggests that's what's happening. So obviously something has to give here, and none of us honestly know what. Other things in this category, honestly, are not all that interesting. Worker comp, we've really done a good job. As a fellow, especially in DPW, Eric, that has sort of led the effort. And this is another one of those things that the town and the schools and sometimes the light department collaborate on and get a lot of good training and good training programs accomplished. And when you do that, you do get credit on your rates and you get good results, for your injuries. Unemployment has clearly taken a big jump. We budgeted unemployment for a lot of position eliminations. It's not any more complicated than that. I'll say that our current run rate in unemployment is actually sort of low. As the budgets have been finalized, this number may be a little high, but it's, we're talking about $10,000 or $20,000 too high. Maybe next November it provides us a little bit of a surplus. We won't know that until really the schools sort out their employment by September. I don't know how much information you want on capital and debt. We usually pair them up, and as you've pointed out, for 2 years, this is the third year, we're spending a little less than 5%. I think it's 4.85. It's pretty close, but every little bit helps. So approximately $100,000 is not being spent on capital that otherwise could. I will say, and I'm not going to go over the capital plan, it's in your packet, that it was very challenging to rebalance the capital plan because of the high school litigation. That is the budget that took the brunt of that, in addition to free cash. And recreation fared the worst, no question. Before John Feudo left, we had a long discussion about every single thing that was going to change in the capital plan, and he was okay with it. So it's hitting an area that's a nice to have as opposed to an essential, and the community is not going to have as nice a time in recreation. Two of the things in recreation for capital that are worth mentioning, though, is the high school two turf fields need to be done soon. They're in the budget. I honestly don't remember. I think it's FY19 and 20, as well as the track. Those are not optional unless you want the fields to go out of use, which I don't think anybody wants. But in terms of putting a new turf field, for instance, in Coolidge, well, maybe 10 years from now, maybe never, I don't know. And I'll also add that recreation generally has a lot of support from the community, not just with applause, but with money. But the town has some obligation, at least on large projects, that it should be paying the $500,000 or $900,000 for turf field. I don't think you can really fundraise for that, but certainly the community has pitched in with smaller amounts, as high as $75,000 to $100,000 on certain projects, on playground improvements. I don't remember the final cost of the Wood End fully handicapped accessible playground, but the community contributed most of that money through donations and charitable drives. Our capital plan, even by it being impacted by this high school litigation, is still very healthy. It's good. Of all the budgets you'll talk about over the next few weeks, I have to say, and I welcome DPW and facilities especially to disagree with me, it's in pretty good shape. The equipment's in much better shape than it was 10 years ago. The facilities are in much better shape than they were 10 years ago. We're at that point where, as a community, we're going to have to struggle with, do we go back to the way it was because the operating budgets are going to be pinched? I don't have any objection at all to $100,000 or $200,000 for the last couple of years being pushed into the operating budgets. But what happened historically was, instead of doing $1.5 million of capital, we did $300,000 or we did $58,000 one year. That is going to be, if there's no successful override and no significant change in services, that is going to be the discussion you're going to see in front of you in the next couple of years. Because there is no other lever that I'm aware of unless state aid goes up more than it is. So just a bit of a caution on capital plans, that it's healthy. It can absolutely absorb even a change in your policy, and we can talk about that in the summer to kick around numbers. It cannot stand a massive change back to the old practices unless you want to cause the same problems as was caused back then. Vocational schools have actually gone down in enrollment over the last few years. I'm not really sure there's a rhyme and a reason other than it's student specific. We now have less students going to the non-traditional Northeast Voc. Those other schools, Essex North, the merged two schools, and Regent and Minuteman, rather, are both much more expensive than the Northeast Voc school is. So when students go there, they're allowed to go there through school choice because our traditional Voc school does not have the exact program that they want. From talking to those superintendents, there's a lot of good marketing going on there. You don't have that? Oh, yes, I do. State assessments is worth noting, even though town meeting and you have no role. We estimated up 2.5% for state aid and state assessments. State assessments went up almost 10% of the governor's budget. State aid went up less than 1%. So we were wrong in both cases and wrong in the direction. You can see the components of it here. It's only the governor's budget. It'll change. But we are now starting to be impacted by some of the non-traditional school education choices. I will tell you that are the neighboring communities, and I would consider Melrose one of them. Melrose is really suffering for this reason. They have an enormous amount of school choice going on where residents are choosing to go to a school in Malden. So Reading is very fortunate that this is not a significant issue to FinCom. And I don't think it will be, but you should be aware that it is for some of our neighbors, so you never know. You know, it could be heading this way.
So they just have different policies in terms of school choice at the school?
It's a really complex issue. Charter schools, I'm not even sure I should say anything. Charter schools have easier rules of operation than a public school does. That's the fairest thing I can say.
Right.
But as a parent, on the other side of that, it's like, oh, aha, charter schools can be attractive to certain students because the rules are a little less strict. So it's a complex issue. I'm sure Dr. Doherty would be happy to chat about you with it. It's not something that's really knocked on Reading's door much. Mm-hmm. It's just now starting to. I'm much more familiar with it, as I'm sure he is, from our peers. It's a significant issue in some of the neighboring towns. That's really it in a nutshell for all the shared costs. I'll have more to say next week. I wanted you to really go through all the town departments plus this little section before I really said much. You know, I did write a few things in the overview. And I do want to just mention that my actions on the school budget will not be discussed without the schools here. So we'll defer that to March 15th. I don't want to say anything without them present. We are going to meet next week to decide whether Sharon and I should even come to that or whether they should just explain it. I'm happy to do, honestly, whatever they want. But just so you know that. To wrap up for the night, if you have any other questions you think of for any of us, please just, you can always shoot me an email. I'll make sure it gets out. If you know other ones, other email addresses, feel free to do that also. If they take research, you might not hear back next week, but you'll hear back. I think the message that you heard tonight and you'll unfortunately continue to hear next week is that, you know, while our pay is a little below average, it's really our staffing levels that's the problem. And as we continue to thin out, it's not helping. But what are you supposed to do? You know, are we supposed to close one of our major functions? Or do we just keep nibbling away at staffing levels? It's not an easy thing. And you can see clearly tonight why we really have to look more than 1 year ahead for some of our departments, so we do it for all of our departments. Turnover is a very expensive thing in any business. It's a little bit more expensive in public safety for the reasons you heard, but it's expensive in every department. We have been a significant source of free cash over the last 5 years because of turnover on unfilled positions. I am certain it's well over $1 million just for that. It's probably over $2 million. That's not a good thing. It's good for the cash reserves. It meant there were, you know, empty positions and services not being provided, or unfortunately existing staff trying to double up and do a lot more. So this budget, you know, optically isn't horrible. The underlying circumstances are getting pretty close to that, though. We have a remarkable quality of employee in our organization. If I could promise you I could keep that for a long time, I would say don't panic. I can't. The next generation coming along is a lot harder to find those kinds of employees, quite frankly. And we don't see that as much in some of our departments as we do in others and as the schools do. But that's something that my peers worry about a great deal, is the quality of the worker, except for Caitlin, that's young and going into this line of work. She's unusual.
You'll never regret having that.
People go into this line of work for lots of reasons. I don't think pay is ever one of them, or hardly ever. Certainly job security might be. We can't offer a whole lot of job security right now as a community. Reading used to be an attractive place to work as a destination. We're starting to slip in that reputation. There's just no question about it. So, you know, what you'll hear from the departments next week is very similar stories about challenges with staffing, just levels. There's any solutions you have, we're always open to. We spend a lot of time talking about it. We do the best we can. There's things at the margin always, but there's very rarely, we never thought of this. And we love to. We wish we could find it. It's just not there. It would be nice if the state and or federal government were not a pest about so many things, but they are. You know, Greg's being very modest when he describes, you know, the FY15 storm reimbursement. I think he's been through four different federal people because they move them around to make it difficult for you. They don't understand that he's a bulldog. He's going to keep taking a bite out of their leg. But how much of his time has been spent to get back those dollars? He has to do it, there's no question. It's not easy. The other thing I'll leave you with is not every part of our organization deals with the public, but our reviews from the public are still very strong. Our service levels are good. Every organization that collects your money gets complaints, but honestly, you know, this community has been well served by its town staff for many years, and I hope that can continue. So, if there's no other questions, we'll see you next week. I guess I have one question. Is FinCom, would you benefit from org charts from every department? I didn't think of that this year.
Yes.
I don't think town meeting wants them, but I have a packet. If you want them, I can email them out before the next meeting. Okay.
Please.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, when I saw your request, I thought, I wish I'd thought of that.
I think it was included last year.
I think it was, yep. I just didn't think of it. By the way, we cut by 35% our number of pages between the towns.
Yeah, I saw that. That's good.
That's good.
With no loss of information. But you got, you know, your feedback on that's really helpful, because this is what's going to go to town meeting more or less.
Yeah.
This is fantastic.
That's good.
It's much easier to read. All the notes are in line with the
right
charts with the summaries.
Yeah,
I know, and all it did was drive people to go, okay, why is this one up, you know, 90%?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
because
no
we
context
redistributed over here, you know, so it's reclassified.
Yeah, I'm not aware of any
so it didn't
piece
even
of information that used to go to you that's not here,
mm-hmm.
Just to be clear, even though it's much smaller. I looked very carefully, and I don't think so. As you'll hear from Joe next week, his budget is sorted very differently. It used to be by building. I didn't see the value of that at all. Now it's by type of expense. But it's all there. So, okay, thanks.
That's great.
Thanks, guys. Thank you.
We good? Can I have a motion?
Thank you.
Can I just adjourn?
I have a second.
Second.
All those in favor?
That's not too bad.
Opposed? We are adjourned.